Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Friday, August 7th, 2015. It was quite a debate last night. We're going to be talking about that primarily, but we're also going to be joined by Alex Jones, who is investigating the globalist takeover of Europe, because it's not just Europe, of course. It is going to be coming here as well. Interesting that we didn't have any questions at all last night about the secretive trade deals, the transatlantic and transpacific partnerships that we have not seen, but of course the Congress has rubber stamped that through without any inspection from our Congress or any say-so about how they're going to amend it. They're not going to be allowed to amend it. That was just ran through. No discussion really, except for Rand Paul. That's why I like to see him in the debate. So it was a very good back and forth between Rand Paul and Chris Christie. Of course, Chris Christie was there as the anti-Paul, as the attack dog. I think they managed to get him just barely into the top 10 so he could fulfill that role. Fox News has a very strong agenda. We're going to talk about that. Of course, they got the most amount of time by far last night. I think it was, we have the exact figures here, but it was well over a third of the time they were on there. Here's the exact figure. 31.7% of the time, you had the anchors talking. And I tell you, the beginning of it was just amazing. Not only looking like a beauty contest, but really more like a sports contest. But they paraded the candidates out there after they had the big stadium and the rah-rah hoo-hoo, you know. They have the candidates paraded out there like beauty contestants, looking very uncomfortable. And you could see Megyn Kelly really kind of enjoying it. Are you guys nervous? I know you don't like standing there. Wave to the audience. And they would do everything dutifully, just as Megyn Kelly told them to do. But it was a great visual there for how presidential candidates in this country really are puppets of the powerful. In this case, they were under the thumb of the Fox News crew. Of course, it was a record audience. They say it was not only the most watched primary debate in history, it was twice as big as the previous record holder. 16% of U.S. homes with television sets tuned in. It's the highest rated Republican primary. In 2011 and 2012, only 5% of households tuned in. So this is more than three times the number of people that watched the last election cycle. And, of course, we'll look at how they selected their particular candidates. They definitely had their sights on Donald Trump. And the more they attacked him, the better he looked. And we're going to play clips of that as well. Ja'Kari Jackson is going to be joining us, along with Joe Biggs, Leanne McAdoo. We're going to have comments from our news staff here. We're also going to take your comments on Twitter, because there's a lot of comments we'd like to get in. So we're going to have a roundtable discussion here. And we're going to look at comments from you. I was live tweeting it last night, and it was actually a lot of fun. Somebody commented and asked me if I was drunk. I said, well, if I did drink, it's times like this, I wish I did drink, because especially the very first debate, the junior varsity debate, was unbelievably dull. Very much like the one that was on Monday night, very constrained. There was no audience. There was no energy to it. It was just a repetition of planned speeches. Nevertheless, Carly Fiorina is definitely the darling of Karl Rove and Fox News. They have done everything they could to make her larger, telling everybody in the audience that she had won the debate, then conducting their audience poll, and surprise, surprise, they fed back exactly as they'd been told. Like a lot of little Homer Simpsons sitting on the couch watching the news, watching the debate, and then being told what they think, and then regurgitating that back into their machines. That's exactly the purpose of Frank Luntz. And Donald Trump had some great takedowns of Frank Luntz and Megyn Kelly. You got to love it when he does that. We're going to play all of this for you, as well as Alex Jones live, and coming up right after the break, a report about what's going on in the Vatican. That's where the mask has come off for the globalist agenda. Alex Jones will be with us right after the break. Stay with us. I'm David Knight, your host. And of course, last night was the debate, the GOP debate that everybody was anxiously waiting for, to see how Donald Trump would do. And of course, they went straight for the jugular in some of the first questions on Fox News. It was a huge debate. As I mentioned in the last segment, they had three times the audience that they did in the 2011-2012 debates. 16% of the United States with television sets tuned in. Well, what did they see? Well, for the most part, they saw the Fox reporters steering the debate the way they wanted to. Not only during the debate, but after the debate, as they brought in Frank Luntz. Last night, if we look at who got the most time, Donald Trump got 10 and a half minutes, and then followed after that by Jeb Bush with 8.5 minutes, then Mike Huckabee with 6.5 minutes, and it falls down rapidly until, of course, the very bottom is Rand Paul with just over 5 minutes. And, of course, he got about 15% less than Scott Walker, who is above him in number 9 place. Chris Wallace, Megyn Kelly, and Bret Baier, however, spoke for 31 minutes and 53 seconds, about 31.7% of the time. And we're going to take a look at what Megyn Kelly has to say. But first, I just want to give you a feel for the content of the questions. If you were watching the debate last night, it's kind of hard to see anything much of any substance. I think the only substantive discussion that was there, we can look at the observations going back and forth with what they had to say, what it tells us about the candidates. But for the most part, most of these questions were personal questions. They weren't policy questions. For example, they come out, the first thing they do is ask them to take a GOP loyalty oath. That was targeted towards Donald Trump, and we'll play that for you. Then they come back, the next question is one on electability to Carson. Then they have a question to Rubio. Explain to Jeb, Rubio, why you, who've never held executive office, should hold executive office. And then he comes back and he says, well, if we're going to play the resume game, Hillary Clinton wins. It's like, really? Really, you think Hillary Clinton's got a great resume? She's got a great rap sheet. She doesn't have a great resume. But of course, it was a great pivot for Rubio because he then came back and said, well, I'm one of you. I'm a poor person. I grew up without a lot of money. I'm like the average American. Only problem is he's not a natural born citizen. His parents were not citizens. Even though he was born in the United States, he's qualified to be a senator. If people elect him, I wouldn't vote for him, but he's not qualified under the Constitution under natural born citizenship, as are neither is Cruz or Jindal for that fact. Then they come into Jeb. Jeb, are you your own man? Jeb comes in. He says, well, in Florida, they called me Jeb and I earned it. To which point we have to ask, what does one do to earn the title Jeb? And what does that mean that you earned the title Jeb? That's going to be the first thing we're going to take a look at. What is going on? Is he really the pro-life candidate that he puts himself out there to be? Next thing, they come back to Trump. Trump, you embody the war on women, and that's a back and forth with Megyn Kelly and Donald Trump. Then to Cruz, Paul says you're more divisive. Then to Christie, you've had 9 downgrades in credit in New Jersey, 44th in growth. Now that's starting to get to an issue, because if you notice, all the governor candidates, people who've had the office of governor, they all tell you how they created more jobs than God did in 6 days. And of course, he has a very difficult record to defend on that. Of course, all the Republican and Democrat who are holding a federal office as a senator will tell you that they have all this foreign policy experience. They've looked ISIS in the eye and ISIS has blinked and they're the guy who can take you to war, and you should be going to war. That's what all of the federal candidates will tell you. All the gubernatorial candidates will tell you how they created jobs and they cut taxes. Then finally, they go to Walker, and we start to get to a real issue. They say, you don't make exceptions for the life of the mother and on abortion. So here we are, 8 questions before we get to something that is really an issue to talk about. We have a loyalty oath. We talk about electability. Are you your own man? Are you an executive? You don't like women. You're divisive. Really? This is the substance of the debate? Absolutely pathetic. But we can discern some of the issues in this, even though they don't really talk about them. Have you guys got that clip ready for Jeb? Let's get that ready. Take a look at these articles that are on InfoWars.com today. Texas launches a criminal probe into gruesome and barbaric Planned Parenthood fetal organ harvesting claims. Now, of course, the governor of Texas is starting a criminal probe. Planned Parenthood has been hit with a defamation charge from the organization that did the video investigations. Meanwhile, what is our Republican leadership doing? The people who, in most cases, got elected to office campaigning to stop abortion. Well, Mitch McConnell says Planned Parenthood should be funded. See, this is one thing there's no debate about with the elites in the Republican Party, and that is that we don't rock the boat. We don't take money away from Planned Parenthood. Mitch McConnell moved swiftly on Thursday, that's yesterday, to shut down any possible conservative attempt to block funding for Planned Parenthood. He says that McConnell would rather have a possibly criminal organization like Planned Parenthood continue to receive money from the federal treasury than to risk a bad news cycle, writes Breitbart. They say McConnell explained that a vote last week seeking to defund Planned Parenthood allowed senators to be on the record against this organization. It says, what are you complaining about? You got to come out and say that you don't like Planned Parenthood. But we're not going to do anything about it. See, that's the way McConnell and Boehner actually operate. You can go on the record and say that you are opposed to this, but don't expect that we're going to do anything about it. Don't expect that we're going to shut down the government if Obama insists on continuing to give taxpayer money to people that we know are enticing women to have abortions and then selling the baby parts. That's precisely what is happening. But let's listen to what Jeb Bush says when he presents himself as the pro-life candidate from Florida.
Welcome back, gentlemen. We're going to move on now to discuss some social issues across the board. Governor Bush, I'll start with you. Many Republicans have been outraged recently by a series of videos on Planned Parenthood. You now say that you support ending federal funding for this organization. However, until late 2014, right before you started your campaign, you sat on the board of a Bloomberg charity that quite publicly gave tens of millions of dollars to Planned Parenthood while you were a director. How could you not know about these well-publicized donations? And if you did know, how could you help a charity so openly committed to abortion rights?
I joined the Bloomberg Foundation because of Mike Bloomberg's shared commitment for meaningful education reform. That's why I was on it. We never had a debate about the budget. It was presented and we approved it, not item by item. Here's my record. As governor of the state of Florida, I defunded Planned Parenthood. I created a culture of life in our state. We were the only state to appropriate money for crisis pregnancy centers. We expanded dramatically the number of adoptions out of our foster care system. We did parental notification laws. We ended partial birth abortion. We did all of this, and we were the first state to do a Choose Life license plate. Now 29 states have done it, and tens of millions of dollars have gone to create a culture where more people, more babies are adopted.
But did you know?
No, I didn't know, but it doesn't matter. I was working on this board because of the education. My record is clear.
Okay, that's
my
good.
Record is a
yeah, he was working on the board with Bloomberg because of education. And what was he doing there? He was promoting Common Core. Now, they gave $10 million to Planned Parenthood, but of course he says that they did all these other things there at the state. We've got license plates that say I'm pro-life and whatever. I don't know how much money the state of Florida was giving Planned Parenthood that he stopped giving them, but personally, when he's director of a charity that gives $10 million to them, something is up. Now, let me tell you what's up with this. Deadstate.org has a good article. Jeb Bush would rather you forget that his grandfather helped to found Planned Parenthood. The connections of the Bush family are very, very deep and long with Planned Parenthood. Can you name any historical figure who helped Planned Parenthood kick off its first fundraising campaign back in 1947? If you first guessed some progressive liberal icon, you'd be wrong. It was Prescott Bush. And when I look at him saying that he's pro-life, I remember that he was governor when Terry Schiavo was executed by a probate judge in Florida. And Jeb Bush would not lift a finger to help her. Neither would his brother, who was president. Either one of them could have and should have helped. Instead, they sat idly by while people who tried to give her water, who tried to give her food, were arrested and taken away. Her husband wanted her taken off of life support. Her family said, we will take care of her. They took her off of life support. She continued to live. She was mentally damaged, but they said that she could communicate with them. But you want to talk about somebody being pro-life? You're going to sit there and watch a handicapped woman be starved to death and arrest the people who try to feed her? Is that pro-life? That's the way the Bushes define it. It is no surprise to me to understand that his grandfather, Prescott Bush, was one of the founders of Planned Parenthood. Here's some more information. First, resurfacing in a 2005 article in the San Francisco Gate, it reveals that their grandfather and their father, the Bushes, Prescott Bush was treasurer of the organization in its early years. They say the political repercussions hit him hard. Prescott Bush was knocked out of an expected victory for the Senate seat in Connecticut in 1950 after a syndicated columnist, Drew Pearson, declared that it had been made known that Bush was a leader in the Birth Control Society. That's the old name of Planned Parenthood. And back in those days, people understood what that was about. And then they go on to show a letter in 1972 from George H.W. Bush to the president of Planned Parenthood. My congratulations to you and your colleagues on your family planning stamp. Efforts like this that would help further such worldwide things of such worldwide importance are something for which this country can justly be proud. I'm honored to own this first day cover. He changed his tune when he joined the Reagan administration. That was a requirement. But the Bush family is knee-deep in Planned Parenthood.
It's time to build your own.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Friday. We're live, and we're going to be talking about the debate last night. Three times the number of people that watched the debates in the last election cycle. The highest rated debate, twice as high as a previous record. And, of course, primarily it was because of Donald Trump. And we're going to have the first back and forth in terms of the loyalty oath. We're going to play that in just one moment. But before I do, I just want to let you know, as a thank you to our audience, we extended free shipping this week. We had had free shipping throughout the month of July. We extended it for one more week because we know a lot of people are traveling on vacation. They might have missed that special. And we've been running flash sales of 24 hours each day this week. We have the biggest flash sale we've had today. Survival Shield X2, 30% off plus free shipping. And this is just for the next 24 hours. Free shipping ends today. And, of course, the sale for Survival Shield X2 will end today. We've just received one of our largest emergency shipments of Survival Shield X2 from the manufacturer. We want to say thank you. And this is the way we're doing it, giving you 30% off of our high-quality nascent iodine Survival Shield X2. Again, that's just throughout today, as well as free shipping. And the free shipping is not just for Survival Shield X2. That's for everything that is in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. You can take advantage of that right now. Let's go back to the debate. And, of course, the debate began with something that I thought was pretty amazing, as well as pretty childish. The whole thing looked like a sporting contest from the very beginning. They have this big arena. They actually even self-consciously talked about how much it was like a sports contest. They even had a Sweet 16 bracket. They had the weather report, essentially. They had some lady standing there with a map that had red areas on it. I fully expected to hear her say that there was going to be a Democrat front moving up from the south and west, expected flooding over the entire nation. But then they go with the very first question to this loyalty oath, essentially asking them, are you going to stay in the Republican Party if you don't win the nomination? Of course, this was targeted directly at Donald Trump, and he didn't back down. This is what happened.
Gentlemen, we know how much you love hand-raising questions. So we promise this is the only one tonight, the only one. Is there anyone on stage, and can I see hands, who is unwilling tonight to pledge your support to the eventual nominee of the Republican Party and pledge to not run an independent campaign against that person? Again, we're looking for you to raise your hand now. Raise your hand now if you won't make that pledge tonight. Mr. Trump.
Of course, Donald Trump raises his hand. And you got to give him credit for the guts to have this. And I think that's why it didn't really stick all their attacks on him.
Republican primary.
I fully understand.
The place where the RNC will give the nominee the nod.
I fully understand.
And that experts say an independent run would almost certainly hand the race over to Democrats and likely another Clinton. You can't say tonight that you can make that pledge.
I cannot say. I have to respect the person that, if it's not me, the person that wins. If I do win and I'm leading by quite a bit, that's what I want to do. I can totally make that pledge. If I'm the nominee, I will pledge I will not run as an independent. But and I am discussing
if he's the nominee,
with
everybody, he won't leave the Republican Party.
We're talking about a lot of leverage. We want to win and we will win. But I want to win as the Republican. I want to run as the Republican nominee.
So tonight you can't say if another one of these.
This is what's wrong. I mean,
okay.
This is what's wrong.
This is Rand Paul.
He buys and sells politicians of all stripes.
He's already, hey, look, he's already hedging his bet on the Clintons, okay? So if he doesn't run as a Republican, maybe he supports Clinton or maybe runs as an independent.
Okay.
But I'd say that he's already hedging his bets because he's used to buying politicians.
Well, I've given him plenty of money.
Yeah, and it turns out that that's not true. He says, at one point, he says, well, most of the people on the stage I've given a lot of money to. And he says, points to Rand Paul, and he says, I've given him a lot of money. Well, the fact is, we've had a lot of organizations do the fact check. Actually, he didn't. He gave $500 to Jeb Bush. He gave essentially zero to everybody else who's on the stage with him, including Rand Paul, zero to him. Rubio put out, he says, most of the people on stage I've given a lot of money to. He tweeted this out. He says, not me. To be clear, you supported Charlie Crist. And that's absolutely true. Now, the question, the reason this comes up, of course, we've mentioned this as well, are the deep ties that Donald Trump has had to the Clinton family, the phone calls that they had in May just before he entered the race, the amounts of money that he's given to them. The Clinton Foundation, according to Politico, got $100,000 from Donald Trump in addition to $25,000 to Democrat candidates in 2006. And of course, is he buying influence? He says, well, you know, when I talk to them, they do things for me. And they do things like what? She came to my wedding. He gave all that money to the Clinton Foundation so she'd come to his wedding. Right. Stay with us. We'll be right back with a report
from
Alex
Jones.
We're on the
march.
Friday, August 7th, 2015. The day InfoWars goes inside the walls of Vatican City to investigate the unprecedented moves by the new pope to openly promote planetary world government, carbon taxes, and wealth redistribution. All of this coming from the leader of an organization that's tax-exempt worldwide and is one of the biggest property owners on the planet and has one of the most wealthy private banks, the Vatican Bank, lecturing the middle class of the planet that they need to pay more taxes to, quote, help the poor. This is a globalist agenda 101. We got the Copenhagen Treaty for climate change 5 years ago. And the whole thing was planetary government, basically double taxes on the third world, but was sold as helping the third world. Under the carbon tax initiatives that Lord Monckton and others have actuaried out and broken down, 1 billion people in a decade will starve to death. Already 35 million people, roughly half of them, children, starve to death each year. Most third world populations spend about 45% of their discretionary income on food. In a global depression, which this system will cause and what it's designed to create, quote, zero growth. That's code word for negative new dark age implosion. You will see 45 go up to 50, 55, 60, 70% of income towards food. When it passes 50 historically, riots break out all over the world. That's why this is so serious. So as we look out on the ancient city of Rome, where we get the word romantic, when we look out on this city, carbon taxes will hurt this city big time. It'll hurt tourism. It'll hurt power prices. It'll hurt the average Roman who's already on the verge of depression. And even the mayor of Rome says the city may collapse. But if you look south of here to Africa or east of here to the Middle East, it is a death sentence to have carbon taxes raised. And this same pope hasn't said a word about Planned Parenthood and its vivisection of babies. It hasn't said a word about the organ selling. He hasn't said a word about anything that past popes would have. So I want to be clear. This is a clear break from previous popes. Folks have wanted me to criticize the Vatican or they've wanted me to defend it. I don't take sides. I just cover the fruits of the tree. And anyone can look at this new pope and say, it's like having, well, Fidel Castro doesn't promote gay marriage, so I guess worse than Fidel Castro. And again, I'm not bashing, quote, gay people out there. The point is that the religion of Christianity and the institution of marriage is about men and women. And it's okay for men and women to have their institutions. Other people can have theirs. This is a complete cultural takeover. So whether it's abortion or marriage, first thing he did a couple years ago when Pope Francis got in, the first Jesuit pope, by the way, was to say, quote, Catholics need to stop obsessing on abortion so much. Well, see, that was one of the great fruits that I could look at Catholics and say, at least they're fighting abortion worldwide. and Planned Parenthood. Now that's just all gone. And so, again, we're going to go into the Vatican. We're going to go in just in a public tour and investigate and then use the backdrop to try to illustrate what's happening and educate people and to really try to spur a debate about this. I mean, we've seen other treasonous, seditious activities by the church under the sky the last 3 years, getting bishops to call for illegals to pour in to the United States and aiding and abetting them to get IDs and driver's license. I mean, I can't go to the church in Mexico and have them do that for me as an American. And again, that's part of the globalist agenda. The Catholic Church fully now is behind the New World Order push for planetary government. They are pushing the agendas 100%. And of course, it was previous popes that fought communism. This pope is 180 degrees the opposite direction of previous popes. I mean, it's that simple. And I know there's all these criticisms of the last four or five, and I get it. I've studied it. But you notice mainstream media pretty much attacked those people. This is about blackmail. The Catholic Church has clearly been taken over. You say what you wanted to about it before, had its problems. But now, being infiltrated by the globalists, by their sex cults, their pedophile cults that infest every major group, just look at the news, they are now able to blackmail the last pope to have him run off to a nearby castle where he basically lives in absentia, where he basically lives like, you know, Napoleon on Alba, where he lives, you know, in exile. And now the church just does whatever basically MSNBC says. I mean, the Catholic Church is now like a religion of MSNBC. It's the religion of Rachel Maddow. I mean, you might as well have Rachel Maddow as the pontiff with the hat on, speaking from the great black throne, ex-cathedral, and that's it. They're God. And so the one world religion is here. Notice world governments being promoted by the Pope, planetary taxes. I mean, it's just unprecedented to see all of this happening. The New World Order is death. It's global taxes. It is a new dark age of control with the elite above the law and exempt. And that's why we're here documenting all of this. We've got tons of great HD footage, interviews all over Rome. We're going to be putting together a mini documentary when we get back to Austin, Texas for InfoWars Nightly News and the syndicated radio / TV show. But it's important that we say no to the globalists and put a clear choice out there to stand up for private property, stand up for family, to stand up for the unborn, to stand up for the innocent, to stand up for basic culture that the New World Order, like the Borg, are trying to overwrite. So we're going into the Vatican, ladies and gentlemen. I don't expect I'll be banned from entering, but who knows, I might be. I've been speaking ill of the pontiff that is this basically, it's like having a Soviet president as the head of the Vatican or something. I mean, it's like having Khrushchev or something as the new pope. Just unbelievably, outrageously in-your-face globalism, and it's just starting because we've now reached the point of no return. We've now reached the event horizon of going into world government, going into the new world order. The good news is people are now awake. The Patriots for 50 years warned us. It's all coming true, so our credibility is very, very high. Your credibility is high as listeners and activists. Get out there. Expose the tyranny. For every action under Newtonian physics, there is an opposite and equal reaction, or equal and opposite reaction. And so understand you have power as well, and now is the time to bring light and salt to the earth. Now is the time to bring light to the world. Now is the time to expose what's happening, because the people are good. And the people of Rome are good. The people of Barcelona are good. The people of Texas are good. The people of, you know, Africa are good. The people of every city, state around the world just want freedom. And I close with these tax-exempt globalists behind these walls, led by this New World Order puppet. It is just outrageous that they would be above the law. It is outrageous that they would be tax-exempt and live like the most opulent kings of history, greater than Roman emperors, on the very hills where, you know, Rome ruled, with the very loot of the Roman temples hauled in to build St. Peter's facility here, is just, again, unprecedented. The hypocrisy, the paradox, is just mind-blowing. They say a picture tells 1,000 words. Video tells 1,000,000 words. Alex Jones signing off for now. Next time, we'll be reporting from inside the Vatican for InfoWars.com, the front lines of truth journalism.
And again, that's Alex Jones reporting from Rome, from the Vatican area. And as we pointed out many times, this is part of the globalist agenda. to take over and to justify world government. Schellenhuber, that the Pope put onto his scientific advisory council, has long been a depopulationist. Isn't it amazing to see the Catholic Church leader distance himself from this debate that's going on in America, not only over what marriage is, but especially over these videos that are showing up in Planned Parenthood? This is something that the Catholic Church has always fought. As a matter of fact, the fellow who did this investigation was motivated because of his Catholic faith to do this. And yet the Pope and the official Catholic Church has largely been out of this. But they're not silent about setting up a global governance because of man-made global warming. As I said yesterday, if you really think that the predominant effect on the climate is man-made, then why do we still have seasons? Okay, think about that. I want to get back to the debate that we had last night, and I want to move on to another topic. And of course, this is one that is dear to my heart. If you've ever listened to me, you know that I care very deeply about the loss of individual liberty that we have had in this country in the name of the war on terror, in the name of the war on drugs. And of course, it's only getting worse with the war on terror. Now, one of the candidates that popped up last night that is being touted by Fox News relentlessly and continuously is Carly Fiorina. And I was really amazed after watching the first debate when they started pumping her. I turned to my wife and I said, really, what did she say? And she said, well, she had a pretty good takedown of Donald Trump. It's like, oh, okay, well, maybe I know that Fox News doesn't like Donald Trump, and they made that very clear in the debate. But it's far more than that, folks. She has some very deep ties to the NSA, the CIA, the surveillance state. We'll talk about that. But first, what do you need to know about Carly Fiorina? This is from the Daily Telegraph. They say, well, she once served as an advisor for John McCain's 2008 presidential campaign. She also was one of the most powerful women in corporate America from 1999 to 2005. She was CEO at Hewlett-Packard. She helped engineer a highly criticized merger with Compaq Computer that resulted in large layoffs. The company's stock price dropped more than 50% during her tenure, and she was pushed out by the board of directors. Not exactly a stellar history here if you're going to tout yourself as a business expert. So she's got 6 years as a CEO, tanks the company stock. 50%, folks, that's pretty serious. Lots of layoffs, and she gets pushed out. But here's the thing that I'm really concerned about. Although she's never held an elected office or served in a cabinet position, after her departure, former CIA Director Michael Hayden selected Ms. Fiorina to chair the CIA's External Advisory Board. In 2007, she warned Mr. Hayden that his spy agency would need to adapt to the public's expectations of privacy. He said she's contributed a great deal. Now, she knew at that time what was going on with the Dragnet surveillance. She had no problem with it. She's telling him, here's how you can spin it. Here's how you can adapt to their expectations. Not, why don't you follow the Constitution? Back on June 11th, she appeared on Fox News Channel's Special Report, and she was questioned by Judge Napolitano. He asked her about her role in helping to create the massive surveillance program while she was head of Hewlett-Packard. And then later, when she joined the CIA's advisory board, he said, one of the things you did, Carly, when you ran HP and in the years after was to help them and then Director General Michael Hayden to set up the most extensive spy apparatus in the world, one that is capable of intercepting every phone call, every email, every text message of everyone in the United States. Are you proud of where that spy system has gotten us today? Should it be dialed back? She says, well, yes, I would dial it back somewhat, but I think it's a bad idea to give up all the responsibility of collecting the data to phone companies because they don't have the ability to do it as well as the government. Yeah, there you go. More of it, and we just need to, the only problem is that the telephone companies aren't doing it well enough. And what she said last night, she went full on for information sharing. She went full on for taking down encryption, for breaking down cyber walls, as she pointed out. She said in the debate last night, we're going to play that clip for you. She said these barriers that are up there, these cyber walls, they need to be taken down by Google and Apple. We need to force them, take them down, because it makes it harder for law enforcement to do their job. And see, that's the primary concern of all politicians, is how do we make it easier for law enforcement to do their job? That is the hallmark of a totalitarian state. We have lost our focus on liberty. We have lost our focus on the Bill of Rights, the prohibition, the rule of law. All we want to do is make it easier for the security state. And as I've said many times, if your only concern is maximum security, you'll find yourself living in a maximum security prison. Here's Carly's comments last night on the surveillance state.
Carly Fiorina. The FBI director Comey says that terrorists can thrive here at home because they go dark and they recruit behind the cyber walls that are built by American companies like Google and Apple. Comey says this is a big problem. But Rand Paul says that the government forcing these companies to bring down those walls would be a big privacy issue and a dangerous way to go on this. You've been a tech leader in this country. Which side are you on?
Well, let me say first that it is disturbing that every time one of these homegrown terrorist attacks occurs, and as your question points out, they are occurring with far too great frequency, it turns out we had warning signals. It turns out we knew something was wrong. It turns out some dot wasn't connected. And so the first thing we have to do is make sure that everyone and every responsible agency is attuned to all of these possibilities and symptoms. We even had warnings about the Boston Marathon bombers, and yet the dots weren't connected. So we need to get on a different mindset. Secondly, I certainly support that we need to tear down cyber walls, not on a mass basis, but on a targeted basis. But let me just say that we also need to tear down the cyber walls that China is erecting, that Russia is erecting. We need to be very well aware of the fact that China and Russia are using technology
to attack us. We need to be aware that we even want to spy on China and Russia, but especially here in America. We need to get those cyber walls torn down, and that's what CISPA has always been about, and they've reintroduced it, calling it CISA. It's still cyber information sharing, where they are giving legal immunity to the corporations, leaning on them to get that information. But as Carly points out, she doesn't really want to be dependent on these corporations to get the information. She wants the government to go get it directly. No discussion whatsoever. No concern of individual liberty, of the Fourth Amendment, or anything else. Now, they had Chris Christie in that debate last night, and you understand the reason Chris Christie made that cut, as low as his poll numbers are, was because they wanted him as the anti-Rand Paul. And we're going to play that clip once we get back after the break, but they wanted somebody who was going to go head-to-head with Rand Paul, and they've been going back and forth in the press well before this debate. They knew exactly where this was going to go, and they pushed that at the very beginning. We're going to have that back-and-forth exchange, and we're going to talk about what is really behind that when we come back from the clip. And of course, that is the fundamental question. Does Christie misunderstand the Fourth Amendment, or does he just have contempt for it? And of course, the answer is he has contempt for it. When you hear Carly, when you hear Chris Christie say, we need to have all the information we can get, and no matter how many times they fail, whether it is 9/11 or the Boston bombing, they want to tell us these are terrorist events that they could have stopped. We have been told by NSA whistleblowers like William Binney and Thomas Drake and others repeatedly that that they had enough, that they could have stopped it, but they didn't. And that everything that they're collecting, the way they're doing, is simply making the haystack bigger and more difficult to find the needle. And that's not really what the purpose of this is about. It is total information awareness on the American people, destruction of our way of life and our rule of law. Stay with us. We'll be right back with that quote. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. We're going to go to that clip I was talking about in the last segment, the back and forth between Chris Christie and Rand Paul, as if the Fourth Amendment really mattered. Of course, we know it doesn't matter to Chris Christie. They put him in there as the bulldog to attack Rand Paul, who is standing up for civil liberties. We're also going to be joined in the beginning of the next hour with Alex Jones. He's going to be calling us live from Rome. He's there reporting on the globalist takeover of Europe. Of course, that's going to be coming here as well. It's a global plan. Before we get back to the clip, I just want to let you know about a special unprecedented sale we have today on Survival Shield X2. We have it for the next 24 hours, 30% off at the InfoWarsLife.com store. That's 30% off and free shipping for that and everything at the store. And the free shipping will end tonight. We had that for the month of July, that expired last Friday. We extended it for one more week as a thank you to our customers. And as an additional thank you, we've got an unprecedented sale on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. You can get that and everything else that's in stock at the InfoWarsLife.com store for free shipping ending today. And again, that's 30% off of Survival Shield X2. It's a great time to stock up. We've got over 400 reviews there. Over 99% of those would recommend it. Let me read you one of those reviews real quickly. John in Camden, Delaware said, I've had immediate good results. I've taken other supplement type items in the past. They seem to help, but I wondered if it was more psychological. With X2, I've had definite and non-refutable results. I immediately was able to have an immediate sustained higher physical output at work. Then at the end of the day, I have a good tired feeling. Therefore, I've been sleeping better as well. It's just awesome. So you'll see a lot of reviews like that. Take a look at those reviews. Decide if it is a product for you if you haven't tried it yet. But again, it's 30% off, an unprecedented sale along with free shipping. Now, going back to this clip, as I pointed out, they brought in Chris Christie to attack the Fourth Amendment, to push the surveillance state. This is a great back and forth. It is something that I think is the most substantive part of the debate. Let's play that clip right now.
Because I'm the only person on this stage who's actually filed applications under the Patriot Act, who have gone before the federal, the Foreign Intelligence Service Court, who has prosecuted and investigated and jailed terrorists in this country after September 11th. I was appointed U.S. attorney by President Bush on September 10th, 2001, and the world changed enormously the next day, and it happened in my state. This is not theoretical to me. I went to the funerals. We lost friends of ours in the Trade Center that day. My own wife was two blocks from the Trade Center that day at her office, having gone through it that morning. When you actually have to be responsible for doing this, you can do it, and we did it for 7 years in my office, respecting civil liberties and protecting the homeland. And I will make no apologies ever for protecting the lives and the safety of the American people. We have to give more tools to our folks to be able to do that, not fewer, and
not just the Secret Court, not just the Patriot Act.
See them to do it the right way as president. That is exactly what I'll do.
Megan, may I respond?
Go ahead, sir.
And the Republicans love that. That's red meat for the Republican base.
I want to collect more records from terrorists, but less records from innocent Americans. The Fourth Amendment was what we fought the revolution over. John Adams said it was the spark that led to our war for independence. And I'm proud of standing for the Bill of Rights, and I will continue to stand for the Bill of Rights.
And Megan, that's a completely ridiculous answer. I want to collect more records from terrorists, but less records from other people.
That's what the NSA whistleblower
said. Megan,
use the Fourth Amendment.
How are you supposed to?
No,
I'll tell you how you look.
Get a warrant.
Let me tell you something.
Get a judge to sign
when
a warrant.
Senator.
Wait, Governor Christie, make your point.
Listen, Senator, you know, when you're sitting in a subcommittee just blowing hot air about this, you can say things like that. When you're responsible for protecting the lives of the American people, then what you need to do is to make sure that
here's
you use the
problem,
system
Governor.
The way it's supposed to.
Here's the problem, Governor. You fundamentally misunderstand the Bill of Rights. Every time you did a case, you got a warrant from a judge. I'm talking about searches without warrants, indiscriminately of all Americans' records, and that's what we fought to end.
He fundamentally, that's the one thing I disagree with Rand Paul about, is that he doesn't fundamentally misunderstand it. He has contempt for it. When he takes Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to be joined from Rome by Alex Jones, who is there now investigating the globalist takeover of Europe. We're also going to be joined by others in the nightly news, by Jakari Jackson, by Joe Biggs, by Leanne McAdoo, with their comments about the debate last night. We're also going to be taking your Twitter comments in the third hour. We want to get your comments and your questions for us, but we're going to talk about what we saw at the debate. We've been talking about the various issues. I have to say that exchange that we were playing in the last segment, and we ran out of time in that last segment, that was, I think, the center point of the debate, because that's about the only time you're going to see the Republicans talk about if the government has gone too far in the surveillance state. We saw Chris Christie bragging about his credentials, saying that he has prosecuted, the only one there who's prosecuted people under the Patriot Act. He has gone to the FISA court. You know that secretive star chamber court they created? It's supposed to be the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. That was set up by the Church Committee because of abuses of our intelligence community, by the CIA, by the NSA. But now they use it as a rubber stamp for surveillance against everyone in the United States. As Rand Paul has pointed out, they go to the FISA court and they say, I've got a search warrant here that I want to listen to Mr. and Mrs. Verizon. I've got another one for Mr. and Mrs. AT&T and so on and so forth. That's the way this has happened now. And so Rand Paul is saying, get a search warrant. Use the Fourth Amendment. People have a right for privacy in their person, their home, their effects. They have completely turned this upside down. You know, they invented the right to abortion out of the Fourth Amendment, saying that that gave people a right of privacy. Isn't it ironic that they can't find any other use of privacy from the Supreme Court except for an abortion? The rest of our obvious privacy rights are totally ignored. Let's play a little bit of that clip at the very end because we didn't get that just before we went to the break. And I think you need to hear it again anyway. Let's play that.
Listen, Senator, you know, when you're sitting in a subcommittee just blowing hot air about this, you can say things like that. When you're responsible for protecting the lives of the American people, then what you need
hold
to
it there,
do
right, is right to there make a sure. Hold it right there a second. When you're blowing hot air. See, he had just said, it's the Fourth Amendment. Get a search warrant. Go before a judge. What do you do when you go before a judge? You say, I have a specific reason to go after this specific person for this and this specific place and time. That's what the Fourth Amendment was for. And Rand Paul is right. That's why we fought the Revolutionary War. That's one of the main abuses of power by the government at that time. But for Chris Christie, if you talk about the Fourth Amendment or the Bill of Rights, you're just blowing hot air because that's what he's been doing. That giant windbag and the rest of the GOP have been blowing hot air in your face, talking about how they love the Constitution and the Bill of Rights as they shred it in front of your face, saying you don't want any liberty, you just want security, and I'll provide it for you. Here's the rest of that. Let's continue on with that.
Sure, that here's the problem, Governor. The way it's supposed
here's
to work.
The problem, Governor. You fundamentally misunderstand the Bill of Rights. Every time you did a case, you got a warrant from a judge. I'm talking about searches without warrants, indiscriminately of all Americans' records, and that's what I fought to end. I don't trust President Obama with our records. I know you gave him a big hug, and if you want to give him a big hug again, go right ahead.
And
go ahead, Governor.
And you know, Senator Paul, you know, the hugs that I remember are the hugs that I gave to the families who lost their people on September 11th. Those are the hugs I remember. And those had nothing to do, with politics. Unlike what you're doing by cutting speeches on the floor of the Senate, then putting them on the internet within a half an hour to raise money for your campaign.
All right.
And while still putting our country at risk.
All right, we're cutting it off there.
Yeah, there he goes. He's running. He's waving the bloody flag of 9/11. Yes, we all know that people died at 9/11. The question is why? And we've had NSA whistleblowers tell us that it was because of the same things that they're now defending. Stay with us. We're going to have Alex Jones joining us, reporting live from the gates of the Vatican right after the break. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. On this Friday, August 7th, 2015, I'm David Knight in Austin, and we take you now live to Alex Jones, who's reporting from the gates of the Vatican City. Alex?
That's right, my friends, and I'm going to be breaking down the developments and what we learned inside in a detailed special tour of the Vatican today. But before we get to that, we'll obviously cover the latest news, breaking analysis, and what's unfolding as we kick off the second hour. But remember, the word Vatican has nothing to do with Christianity, but the goddess, basically the word Vatican comes from, who could tell the future. And the group that came before the Romans actually worshipped at a holy site where the Vatican is built today, the goddess of the Vatican, or it translates into a longer word but means Vatican in Latin. And so that's what Google and the New World Order and the NSA want to be able to do, is basically control the future by mass manipulating the population and surveilling us to be able to then project and predict the future and then, of course, dominate and control the future. And it's so amazing to live in the day and age, growing up as a child, you know, hearing that someday you'll hear a pope call for world government and world taxes and a world religion. And when you hear that, it means that's the false prophet. Whether that's true or not, boy, how did all these preachers I listened to on the radio in Dallas when my mom was driving me back and forth to school or to the grocery store, how did that now come true? I mean, whether it's biblical, whether it's people predicting the future, whether it's prophecy, it's happening. And we're talking about world government of an unelected group of private central banks taxing everything we do, being fed in to the United Nations, into the IMF, into the World Bank. And then Vatican City itself, just literally a quarter mile from me, the walls are just through the woods right there, is the most sovereign state in the world. And the Pope is still the only true, completely sovereign monarch because no laws apply. They tell you this inside the Vatican. No laws apply, no taxes, no regulations, absolutely infallible, in their words, with the two keys. One, temporal, earthly power. One, the power over souls. They believe the Pope himself can say, excommunicate, and you're going to hell. So we're talking God on earth. And now that God on earth is saying world government's the answer, and don't talk about abortion anymore. As the new Papa said a few years ago when he got in, he said, Catholics obsess over abortion too much. You can actually, that's the quote, obsess. He said in the Latin, you can pull it up. So stop obsessing. Sell those baby parts. The Papa will help. The Papa will push the world government on you. So I'll be breaking that down in the next segment. And again, I believe that most of the Catholics I know are really good, hardworking, smart people, and I judge a tree by its fruits. And these are people fighting corruption, fighting evil. So I've not sat here in judgment saying the Catholic Church is evil, the Catholic Church is apostate, the Catholic Church is the devil. I'm just a Christian. I'm not a Protestant. I'm not a Catholic. I'm not a Calvinist. I'm sorry. I don't believe in, you know, total predestination. I do believe God is inclined towards certain people, and certain people are, you know, blessed if they take those blessings in their hands. But at the same time, you got to judge a tree by its fruits. And I'm just non-denominational, non-partisan. I just love life, love justice. This new Pope is an abomination. And people are shocked by the fact that I never get into, you know, religious attacks here on air. They've gotten political. A guy that says he's above the law, who says he has the keys that Christ basically handed down, you know, to St. Peter. Well, I mean, this guy's the opposite of what St. Peter talked about. That's all I know. That's why Catholics across the board are freaking out right now, because this is an unprecedented time to be alive. And it's like when Pastor Hagee, who I really like on a lot of fronts, really good preacher, preaches a lot of good stuff, put a book out, you know, and basically said Jesus didn't come to be the Messiah, but was a rebel. I mean, that guy's a Protestant, had to be exposed. So I just tell it like it is. You can sit there and make up your own mind if I'm wrong, but this is outrageous. And I'll tell you, most people, Catholic, agnostic, Christian, you know, whatever, Protestant, they're really freaked out about what's happening. Now, continuing here, David, we're going to skip this network break so we have more time, because I want to get your take on this when I get more into it. This has to be met head on, because quite frankly, the reason I've not criticized the Catholic Church the last 20 years on air was I really weighed the good they did versus the bad, and the fact that the people I knew fighting the New World Order, fighting the Federal Reserve, fighting abortion, were disproportionately Catholics. A lot of folks at the John Birch Society, you name it. And they just were doing so much good. When the Pope comes out and calls for world government carbon taxes that'll kill a billion people conservatively, in Lord Monckton's own analysis of the next decade, it's got to be met head on, and it's got to be met truthfully, point blank, that if Pope Francis isn't the devil, he might as well be. Okay, so I'm going to get more into that coming up in a moment. Now, continuing here, ladies and gentlemen, there's a new video on Infowars.com. Hopefully we have time, so I really want to focus in on these unborn children. That won't make Francis happy. He says I'm obsessing on it. I'm just a human that loves innocence. Just instinctively, at a spiritual level, I have to fight for him. I'm sorry, Papa. Sorry, Mr. Jesuit. I apologize. Actually, I don't apologize with you. He's here right now. He's like a half mile from me right now. And we pull stunts where he lives in a one-bedroom apartment now instead of his armored palace. Oh, so that's okay. No, give up the trillions. You want the middle class to pay more taxes? You know, come out for the unborn and say that's the main focus here. When if you actually push for it, we could probably overturn it and save millions of lives a year. But no, it's okay because you're a communist. I'm sorry. I'm ranting here. There's a new video that makes me so angry. Fetus organs 15 years ago. When I saw this video 5-6 hours ago posted at Infowars.com, it was like a punch in the stomach. Because you've heard me on air say for 20 years, I've told you they're selling people's organs, killing the fetuses, harvesting them. Then when I saw that video, I'm like, oh, I remember that video. I remember George Woolley, the local Catholic guy on Access TV, Republican activist in Austin. I know, I think he's like a precinct chair or something. I haven't seen George in years. We should have him on. Who I used to go protest at abortion clinics with. He aired that video. 15. I think it was about 16 years ago. On Access Television. It says the food like having their arm. Yeah, I'm sorry, David, go ahead.
Sorry, we just had a freeze there for a moment, but you're back with us, Alex. I just started to come back in. It looks like the Skype froze.
Oh, thank you so much.
No,
absolutely. Thank you. The miracle of Skype. I am back here. But I digress. There's this new video. It was a punch in the stomach because I get mad at myself. I'm just on air saying I've known about this for 20 years. You know, we've seen research. We've seen documentation. And I don't go back and dig up where I saw it or where I heard it. And then here's just one of the examples with people sitting around on video going, we'll get you the baby parts. We'll get you the organs. You know, we've got them all blood typed out. That new video, which is an old video, is up on Infowars.com. So the truth is coming out. Some people say, well, this is old video. Who cares? Or you know, if it's been going on forever, that gives it precedence. So what? No, people's consciences are now seared to a point that either they're going to go along with this or their hearts are open and they're going to stand up against it. And more people are standing up against it right now. The poll numbers show that. That's why this old news is becoming new news, is because more people are now investigating it. More people are now exposing it. We tell people 16, 17 years ago this was going on, and they said, there's no way, you're crazy. Just like when my dad, who's a physician, told me when I went to get my driver's license, he said, don't sign the organ donor card. And I said, why? And he goes, the word is from surgeons I know at some hospitals, they won't save you because they can get a couple hundred thousand dollars. That was back in, you know, the early 90s, like 1990, I guess 1989 or so, I guess, when I got my driver's license, excuse me. And then later I saw it on 60 Minutes that Dallas and Chicago were the two cities they had in the show were killing people and taking their organs. And I was like, whoa, wow, my dad really knows what he's talking about. So people are in denial about this, but as it's exposed, it forces them to admit that this is happening. It forces them to admit it's unfolding. So number one, there's that new video. Number two, then I'll get into the really important news here. Trump was given twice as much time during the debates than Rand Paul and all the other people respectively. Some of them he was given even more than twice the time. I want to be clear. I love what Trump's saying, telling Megyn Kelly, shut up. You know, I'm going to say whatever I want. Political correctness is killing this country. We don't have time for it. I love him saying cut income taxes by 40% down to the average rate being about 10, 15%. The economy would just roar. Kennedy cut it by 50% in the medium rate and less than some of the others. But overall, 50% for the largest tax rate for the middle class. I mean, just absolutely made the economy explode. Biggest coffer increases that they'd ever seen because it just speeds the economy up. The problem is it doesn't give them an economy they can control. The globalists already have tax exemption through the regulations they've written. So they get more power and control because it's an unlevel playing field. If we had fair taxes, they'd be very low because the elite don't want to pay high taxes. It's very simple. I know you know that. We've got to get that word out. So I like what Trump's saying. But even Zero Hedge, which are some smart cookies, they're saying, is he a Democrat, wolf in sheep's clothing, posing as a paleo conservative? Well, regardless, it shows how popular this message is and going against political correctness and going against intimidation. So when Rand Paul, who I admire, who I've known for 20 years, comes out and complains that Trump was given double time, they are giving him double time because they think they can destroy him later. But the main reason they're doing it is because of ratings. And if you are making the incendiary comments, which are needed because we're facing tyranny, if you were being hardcore and if you were being aggressive like Trump, you would be in his position right now. We know we can trust you. So we're months into this. And I know Rand Paul listens to the show. I know his people do. Get aggressive. Get in their face. Throw the firebombs at the enemy politically. That's what you need to do. And you've been doing it on Planned Parenthood. You've been doing it on the attack on Syria. You've been doing it on so many issues, on the Patriot Act. You've taken some incredibly bold stance, but you've got to feed them the meat and potatoes that they need on the imploding borders and the globalists taking over. I know they've sold you as a libertarian to be, oh, we need good immigrants, oh, it's okay, blah, blah, blah. I get we need good immigrants, but the criminals and the people above the law and the anchor babies, you need to expose that. That's not fair. That's wrong. And people across the board, including Hispanics in major polls, give the rash, should we pay for anchor babies? Say, of course not, because they know their tax money's going to it. Just like we shouldn't pay for people's abortions with tax money or their sex changes. I'm not against somebody who want to have a sex change. Don't make me pay. You want to kill your baby? Don't make me pay. Okay? So that's what this comes down to, is common sense. Get hardcore on the social issues. Be a real paleo-conservative constitutionalist. A libertarian stands up for individuals, including the littlest, most defenseless ones. That's what Rand Paul needs to do. People need to call him and give him a donation. But when you do it, say, no more donations if you don't get like Donald Trump and get hardcore. Explode out to the front. Get aggressive. You will dominate. Stop listening to the establishment Republicans. We know what you have on your staff. They're not all bad. Some of them are. Now, continuing here, here's the really big news. There's video up on Infowars.com. Hopefully next hour, if we have time, we'll play a clip of this, because this is really big. I want to get David Knight's take on this here in just a moment. Again, we just skipped this network break. I'm Alex Jones, reporting via Skype from outside the gates of Vatican City, where the so-called Whore Babylon, the Pope Francis is residing. Excuse me, I got things. I thought it was Mr. Madoff for a minute. But continuing here, looking at these notes I've written down, unprecedented video up on Infowars.com with the State Department spokesman says, quote, they do not know the legal authority that the president has and where it comes from to order U.S. forces to attack Syrian troops. That's a close quote. That video is on Infowars.com. This is unprecedented that they would even admit this. I mean, we're talking about the announcement last week. It starts this week to bomb Syrian forces. 2.5 years ago, military said they wouldn't be part of this. General Dempsey, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, went there and said, you can't do it. Congress said, you know, we need to look at this. Funding the radical Islamists that are the Free Syrian Army to attack 90%+ of ISIS. We've had Colonel Schaefer on. They are al-Qaeda based. It is a takeover army of Saudi Arabia against peaceful Syria. It is a war crime. It is pure evil. It is so bad. And now it's just not even a big political issue. Before they tried to sell, they got chemical weapons. They used them on their people. Wasn't true. It was the al-Qaeda forces. Even the UN had to admit that, because al-Qaeda put out videos celebrating it. They bragged about it. Okay? I mean, because they're not controlled. They're just stirred up and released. So they released that video. And it all came out the Syrians didn't do it. Syrians said, we'll give up our chemical weapons. The U.S. has them. Europe has them. But we'll just give ours up. Just leave us alone. That wasn't enough. And then now, 2.5 years ago, like it's not even an issue. They're like, oh, by the way, start next week. That was last week. We're going to start bombing any Syrian forces that have valiantly fought for 5 years against al-Qaeda and Saudi Arabia, now under the banner ISIS. So Obama won't bomb ISIS. He says missiles aren't the answer, but he will bomb Assad forces that are fighting in hardcore street battles against these vicious murdering scum. And they've been pushing back the rebels. So that makes them incredibly angry. That makes the State Department and our wicked baby killing, devil worshiping, narcotics trafficking criminals that have hijacked this government, makes them so angry that people would stand up against their al-Qaeda forces that are blowing up churches, throwing priests off buildings, you know, all the rest of this garbage, chopping nuns' heads off, raping people, forcing fathers to suicide bomb or they'll kill their whole family. All of this is going on, and now Obama has come out and said, we're just going to start attacking. And they said, what authority do you have? And he said, I don't need any authority. You know, I got it out of basically out of Cracker Jack's box. Or I guess he found it, you know, when he was on the toilet. I mean, I don't know where he found it. It's called dictatorial. Where did he find the power? He just announced to shut down hundreds of more power plants and put carbon taxes on us outside of law. Where did he find the authority to dissolve the borders 2 years ago and pay to have people shipped in and give them secret vouchers and order the media not to cover, but we broke it with Drudge and forced it out there. Infowars.com and DrudgeReport.com helped make that a national story. New York Times had to admit, yeah, the government completes the smuggling process, but it's good. It's liberal. So that's what's going on. We have the president preparing a full-out aerial bombardment against a country to be the air support for al-Qaeda. Remember Rand Paul talked about that. Remember Ted Cruz talked about it. We as a listening group, as activists, need to get that out again and try to foil this criminal act again, at least slow it down as much as we can. We've done it before. Can we do it again? That's up to the military folks that are listening. But this is all about lawlessness. It's all about groups that are above the law, the UN, the captured Vatican, you name it. But there it is, the video on Infowars.com. They don't know where the authority comes from, just like they don't know where any of this authority comes from for him coming after our guns or him running Fast and Furious or the IRS persecuting people. The authority comes from dictatorial activity and a lapdog-controlled media that's willing to go along with this. I mean, what's wrong with you people? So continuing, it's all about being above the law. It's all about them thinking they can get away with anything. And that's why, as a society, we're in so much trouble. That's why when we see the Texas Attorney General, you heard it here first months ago, has now been indicted because he encouraged two people as an investment advisor before he was in his position now to invest in a company and didn't tell them that he was a member of it. I mean, that's crooked toenail type corruption. That's having dust on the window seal and a white glove West Point inspection. I'm not defending it. I think it's a little unscrupulous. He paid a $1,000 fine for not remembering to file because he kind of quit doing that business when he got more into government a few years ago and got successful. And then he kind of just on the side did a few other deals. I mean, I forget to pay bills sometimes. I bounce checks not that often, maybe once a year. I mean, I just had one the other day that I had an automatic payment that stopped and I forgot. And there were, I mean, you know, the FBI could call that wire fraud, you know, the way these laws are written. And so he is now going to be put in prison, I predict. They've got a whole showboat group, Justice Department run through the state. And that intimidates everybody else. Hey, you want to fight Obama on the open borders, on the paid for abortion taxpayers, on gay marriage in Texas, on shutting down power plants? We're going to throw your ass in jail because we're not going to let Governor Abbott, who was the attorney general, work with his friend to defend Texas. We're going to throw you all in jail. That's why I'm predicting next they'll indict the governor. And why not stop there? Why not indict any Tea Party people? Because this is what it is. They can do Fast and Furious. They can do Benghazi. Hillary can take money from foreign dictators at the State Department and give them billions in weapons and just do it publicly. I mean, they can just – it's the equivalent of them chopping up 500 children on the White House lawn with machetes and barbecuing them or throwing them down, you know, wood chippers. And then the attorney general punched a 15-year-old punk in the face who was being obnoxious at a dinner or something. I mean, is it illegal to get up and punch some rude kid at some restaurant who's throwing food at somebody and tells your wife to go to hell? Yeah, it's illegal technically to punch him in the face. Is it illegal to chop up 500 children with machetes and then lick the blade? No. So commit the giant, massive crimes nakedly in front of everyone and then run around arresting Republican governors and Republican attorney generals. And it's not that the Republicans are perfect. The Republican leadership has teamed up with the Democrats to mop up and to even get rid of the two-party system and have a one-party ruling clique. That's the point, is there's a massive consolidation taking place right now, ladies and gentlemen. And it is full bore, and folks have been told, join with it, go along with it, submit to it. And so it's a very, very dark time to be alive. David, we're going to go to break. I'm going to come back with about five more minutes with you and go back and forth with some analysis and get your take on this situation. And I don't mean to get vitriolic and aggressive about the Pope. It's just that if we had somebody like that fighting for the lives of children or fighting against carbon taxes, we could win this. Pope John Paul II wasn't perfect. A lot of Catholics criticized me when I say his record seemed pretty good, but at least he fought communism. You know, he didn't run around promoting gun control. I mean, this Pope is so bad. It just really hurts me that he could be a champion for children and for sovereignty and for families. And instead, he's like basically Hugo Chavez took a, or worse. I mean, Fidel Castro, you know, the Pope a half mile from me, David, taking us out to break. I just really get aggressive because we've got put in a trance where we just put up with more and more. How far will this go, David Knight?
Well, Alex, you know, you were talking about what's going on with the Vatican. And earlier in the program, we talked about how Jeb Bush campaigned as the pro-life candidate, saying, well, we let him have pro-life licenses, and yet his grandfather was running the very first Planned Parenthood fundraiser back in 1947. George H.W. Bush was very much involved with the president of Planned Parenthood in the 70s. This is something that's happening not with just the leadership of the Catholic Church. Something that's happening with the leadership of the GOP, who says that they stand for pro-life. We'll be right back with Alex Jones. Joining me now in this segment is Leanne McAdoo. We've been talking to Alex Jones, who is reporting live just outside the gates of the Vatican City. As Alex was pointing out, even though the Catholic Church has stood firmly on the right to life, stood firmly against abortion, we now have a pope who says you just need to get over this obsession. We see the same thing happening in the GOP. As we were pointing out, Jeb Bush saying that he is the pro-life candidate. Nevertheless, he was director of Bloomberg organization that gave $10 million to Planned Parenthood. His father was working with them on fundraisings back in the 1970s, and his grandfather was running the very first fundraiser back in 1947. That's what we're up against, the takeover at the top of these organizations where the grassroots really wants to see something happen, whether it's pro-life or whether it is trying to get back our freedom and our liberty, and yet we're being taken over at the top. Joining us now from the Vatican City is Alex Jones. Alex?
That's right, David Knight. And I was just thinking during the break that I intend to come on air and be smooth and lay out the facts, but I start hyperventilating and getting upset, and then I realize that's good. The InfoWars is because we have a heart. We care. We know we're being conquered by an evil death cult. We know we're being taken over. We understand it, and it's a normal to act like an anthill that's been stomped on when you're under attack. But shifting back into what you were just covering, just like we cover in the film Endgame, and I plug Endgame every day, it's free online, Blueprint for Global Enslavement. Because we have the documents, we have the quotes, we have their own statements 8 years ago when people weren't talking about this, how Planned Parenthood was the eugenic society, how they took over, how they funded Hitler, what their mission is, what they're doing, how the other breakoff groups are the ones poisoning the water, engineering the GMOs to reduce our fertility. Folks, if they're selling baby parts for decades secretly and selling their organs and keeping babies alive and harvesting them, that's all come out. Of course, you heard it here before. I'm not bragging. I mean, we don't make stuff up. Think about the David Knight piece we put together 2 years ago, the membrane put together, where he and I talked about all this, where we tie it into Soylent Green. And so the good news is this stuff was hidden except for insiders and really smart folks. Just like 30 years ago, nobody knew the Federal Reserve was private. Now everybody does in polls, over 90%. The good news is it's coming out. This type of evil can't continue. They're now trying to go, big deal, we sell baby parts. What do you think we're going to do, throw them in the trash? They're worth a lot of money. So next you counter, okay, give the women $200,000 for the baby parts. See, there's a lot of ways to get them. Sue them now. That's why I get these evil demons don't care about their kids. Sue them because you weren't told they were selling the parts. You didn't give consent. See, there's a lot of angles to this and more than one way to skin a cat. And even if you're for abortion, and I get some of the quasi-arguments out there, I don't judge everybody that's for it. I get the deception. I understand the excuses. I understand the lies. I've been involved in them at a distance. You know, when I was in late high school and in college with a few girlfriends that had them, and I'd learn about it after the fact. So I'm not here judging anybody. I'm saying above the whole abortion debate, above that is the real social engineering that's going on. And when I've talked to so many so-called liberals, they go, well, of course there's too many poor people. We got to get rid of them. Well, then why do you try to make the public dependent? Why do you try to dumb the public down? Why do you? Because they want us in a servile, dumbed-down position so they can carry out secret scientific experiments on us, tax us, regulate us, dumb us down. I mean, one out of three kids by 2025, even the CDC predicts, in 2025, 10 years from now, this isn't some distant Buck Rogers, one out of three will have a neurological disorder from vaccines. They just say, you'll have a neurological disorder. And that's not a big, huge story. It's just, well, one out of three won't be able to talk. It'll be in diapers for their whole life. Everything's fine, though. We love you. By the way, we're a Nazi death cult that's sworn to kill you and your family that loves the Ku Klux Klan, but everything's okay. And then they've got all these liberal publications going, Alex is a racist, talking bad about Planned Parenthood. I mean, they've had the last month that I've seen without looking five articles out of Raw Story and Salon and all these White House connected groups going, Margaret Sanger wasn't racist. She was a sweetheart. Jones is a racist. Okay. Don't listen to him. Margaret Sanger loves you and your family. And Hillary Clinton says she's a great lady she admires. So this is the garbage we're talking about. And then they're cutting off our resources to bring this whole plan in. And again, the Bushes. Prescott Bush was the number one lawyer at Brown Brother Harriman. And he was a senator. And they were going to indict him with the McCormick-Dickstein Committee investigation for what they'd done a few years before in the mid-30s, trying to hire General Smedley Butler of the Marine Corps to lead a 400-plus-thousand man team. I have the film reels in Endgame of him saying this, and it's congressional record. The Bushes were going to lead with Butler a 400-plus-thousand man team to bring in fascism and merge with Hitler. Now, the decision was made at the British level to double-cross Hitler. And in fairness to the Bushes, they've been told that was the plan with the British intelligence, was to give them Europe, then the rest of the world would be British Empire under the U.S. And a lot of racists love this. They go, this is wonderful. They were going to have race laws. They were going to put poison in the food and water of the minorities. They were going to carry out what they do to everybody, just against minorities. And then the plan was made after Hitler was defeated. This is all basically declassified, if anybody wants to go research it, to just do it to everybody. And when my dad was at UT as a high school student, in their advanced Plan 2 program, they called him in and said, listen, this isn't racist. We just want the smartest people to be part of a covert eugenics program. And he never got deeper into it because, you know, his dad had been in World War II and he thought that was pretty horrible. And they said, well, listen, you know, even the head professor said, I'm Jewish and this is okay. You know, we're not doing this like Hitler. This is going to be done to the general public, and we're just going to have a ruling elite. They didn't get into poisoning everybody and stuff, but, you know, that was there. So if you want to know what you're under, this whole Planned Parenthood thing and selling the baby parts and keeping the babies alive to sell their organs, as I told you before it came out, they did. From our sources, this is a window into it. Gets a lot worse. I mean, if they're going to kill babies and sell their organs secretly, you think they're going to jack your water? Well, the White House science czar in 1974, 41 years ago, the year I was born, he's current White House science czar, but I was born 41 years ago. John P. Holdren wrote an 1,100-page book, Eco-Science. It's online for free now. And they talk about putting stuff in the water to reduce your IQ and to lower your fertility. Well, guess what they do? And I know I harp on this ad nauseum as I stand out here in record hot, I guess global warming, Roman heat, 98 degrees, just literally a half mile from the Vatican that's right there. You know how cameras are. They make stuff look smaller. I mean, the dome is just right there. The wall is just down the street, literally 200 yards away. And I sit here and I look at this and I see how they feed on us and how the globalists operate. And just every fiber of me, I guess we need to make an Endgame part two and just lay it all out in the Nuremberg documents. And listen, they didn't just get this eugenic stuff from the Nazis. The Nazis got it from the West, England and the U.S. They made it even worse. And then at Nuremberg, they took what the Nazis had and incorporated it into how we operate, not just at NASA, not just in the CIA, as everybody knows, but they incorporated it into the banking. They incorporated it into regulations. The 1968 Gun Control Act, it was used for preservation of firearms that discovered this, is word for word, except for like seven words have been changed from Reich to United States, stuff like that, is the Nazi Gun Control Act that they repassed. And it was Senator Dodd, not the current one, but the previous one. Senator Dodd, you can look this up, that was a lawyer at Nuremberg and just took it and made it U.S. law, which had been previous Weimar Republic, then recertified by the Nazis to be technical. So I mean, we literally live under, the EU was a Nazi blueprint. And guess who was at the Treaty of Rome in 57 and supported the EU? The Vatican. Guess who's not a member of the EU and is exempt from it? They want you under the EU, but the men that have hijacked the church, because regardless it's been hijacked, they are exempt. They are above it. They don't have to follow it. Only you and your family. That's what's happening. That's the fraud. Because if they were under all this, if they were under the taxes and regulations, if they were under all this hellish stuff, then they wouldn't like it. But it's okay. You know who is a spokesman for the Vatican now and who works for him and is part of the Swiss Guard, the guy that helped launch the Iraq war with lies, Tony Blair. So you can say what you want about the Vatican in the past. It undoubtedly stopped a radical Islamic takeover of Europe. It undoubtedly did a lot of good things. I'm not somebody that just obsesses all day and says the Vatican is the fount of all evil. It's bad people that run the U.S., bad people that run banking in England, bad people that have hijacked the Vatican, because then you can't debate it. Whether it was good or bad before, this is what's going on, and where is the Papa who's supposed to protect the little sheep? Where is he exposing the eugenics? Well, I'll tell you, they took out the last pope, who certainly wasn't perfect, Benedict, right as the blackmail, admittedly, it was even in the London Guardian, Associated Press, that blackmail was being used. It even came out in mainstream news of the pedophile rings inside the Vatican that basically infiltrated and took it over, a sex cult, and that now are blackmailing everyone in it to submit to them. So you're going to hear more and more stuff. You may hear the Pope come out and say, hand your five-year-olds over to, you know, guys on the street or you're going to hell. I mean, you may see him out there with a rainbow flag, you know, in a leather outfit on South Park with Lemmy Winks. I mean, there is no, I'm not kidding. I mean, there is no telling what you're going to see because that's what this has turned into. And that's what's unfolding. We had a giant seagull flying by right here to see if we can get some food. Continuing, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Alex Jones reporting for InfoWars.com. We need to get aggressive. We need to get out of the trance. We need to stop submitting to the tyranny of the New World Order. You know, the great Roman people who come from those hills out there, those volcanic hills outside home, who more than 2,700 years ago founded this great city, they need to find their fighting spirit and not be slaves to this and take back their society as well. I don't care where you come from, who you are. It's now the time to do this and to take action. Now, I'll be back maybe this Sunday doing the show. If I'm too exhausted, we've been shooting a lot of footage for a documentary. It'll be David Knight, who's just, I want to say he's done an amazing job. But I'll definitely be back here live Monday, Lord willing. So thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support. I wanted to get David's take on this situation. And then as we go to break, we're not tax exempt. We're not the New World Order. We're not above the law. We're funded by you. And because of your support, I'm able to have reporters to cover Bilderberg. I'm able to have the nightly news, have the radio show. We're reaching 20 million people a week. We're having a giant effect. We're reaching, just on one YouTube channel, 6 million a week now. But if you count everything together, it's 20 million conservatively. So I want to salute you. I want to thank you for your support. Plus, we have great products at InfoWarsStore.com. As we go out to break, David will tell you about, I know we've extended free shipping. Was just in the month of July. It's now going to run through this weekend. It will end Monday morning. So free shipping does end Monday morning. Got a lot of other specials that are going to be ending. David can talk about some of those specials in a moment. But David, more and more I realize it is about getting out of the trance. It is about getting angry. I used to see Network, you know, 30 years ago and think from 1976 and think, you know, the answer is get up, say you're mad. And, you know, I don't know how to fix all the problems, but I'm angry. I think, no, that's not true. But really it is. Get your blood pumping. Realize there's a problem. Get aggressive. Stop submitting to tyranny. Stop going along. And vote with your dollars to support freedom. Spread the word about evil by exposing it. Promote what's good. Word of mouth will bring down the New World Order, a velvet revolution. David Knight.
Absolutely, Alex. And I think we saw that to some degree last night with Rand Paul. As you pointed out, he needs to take a libertarian argument and come after the open border. I think one of the ways to do that is to say we all stand for equal protection of the law. However, illegals are being incentivized to come here, and basically there is no law for them. They are given legal immunity even when they're violent criminals, are given in-state tuition, and every state benefits that we don't see, and we cannot afford, and this is a libertarian argument, we cannot afford this Cloward and Piven strategy of creating a vast welfare state and then bringing in people who are going to go on that welfare state. No other country does that, and we should not be compelled to support that. We need to get angry about that. I think that's the tack that I would certainly take. Perhaps you'll do that, but I think we had some of the best back and forth last night, nevertheless, with Rand Paul and Chris Christie, understanding that they brought Chris Christie in as a pit bull for the police state to take on the very issues that they knew Rand Paul would take on, to attack those issues, to attack Rand Paul. I've got Leanne McAdoo with me, and we're going to talk about what happened with Carly Fiorina as well as Donald Trump. Before we do, as Alex was pointing out, we've extended free shipping for another week as a thank you to you, and we have also put in a 24-hour special on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. That's our high-quality, nutraceutical-quality iodine. You can take it in a nutraceutical quality format without having to take an injection. It's liquid. It's easy to take. We've got a lot of reviews. You can see those at our website. We've got over 400 reviews, over 99% positive. We've got a large emergency shipment of this in. It's a great time for you to stock up on it while we not only have free shipping for the next 24 hours and then it stops. We've extended it only for a week and then it's going to end. But we also now have 30% off Survival Shield X2. It's an unprecedented sale that we have for Survival Shield X2. Again, it's our way to thank you for supporting us with the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Well, Leanne, it was interesting last night. I think really we could see that they had the guns out for Donald Trump.
All right,
Trump.
That's it. I'll go.
And I think that, yes, thank you, Alex. That's Alex from reporting from the gates of the Vatican, right outside the Vatican, talking about how they're now talking about a different agenda than they have throughout the history of the Catholic Church. And we see that within the Republican Party as well. Certainly Fox had an agenda. Their agenda was to try to take down Donald Trump. And I think one of the things that caused them, there's a couple of reasons I think they were pushing Carly Fiorina. They have renounced her over and over and over and over and over again as the winner. And I think the two things that they liked about it, number one, she succinctly came after Donald Trump. And number two, I don't think most people in the public really realize the close ties that Carly Fiorina has with Michael Hayden and the CIA and the surveillance state. She's been an advisor for them after she left Hewlett-Packard. She was an advisor for them while she was there. And that's really what's behind this. They are really pushing this surveillance state, the war state, the prohibition state. You can see this everywhere. We've had Megyn Kelly forcing vaccines on people, saying sometimes you just need Big Brother. They are selling Big Brother to us all the time, not just with mandatory vaccines. Fox News is selling us Big Brother, Big War all the time. And so they had Carly Fiorina coming after Donald Trump. Your comments?
Well, I thought she did an excellent job, like you said, very succinct. And you've made this point as well, just showing how he has flip-flopped on so many things. So what is going to actually make him change his stripes if he becomes the big guy there in the big chair? And I think as well, Fox News realizes he can take down the Republican Party, basically, if he runs as an independent, as well as the war on women.
Yes, they started out the main debate with a loyalty pledge, and that was directed directly at Donald Trump. When we come back, we're going to play Carly Fiorina's takedown of Donald Trump that Fox News loved, and we're going to talk about the issues behind that. And there are some real issues with it. We'll be right back. Leanne McAdoo. We've been talking this program about the debate last night. It was a big debate. Three times the number of people that watched the debates back in 2011 and 12, twice the number of the previous record for debate. And there's one reason for that, and that's Donald Trump. Everybody tuned in to see the fireworks, and there were a lot of fireworks.
Right.
And of course, one of the things that was very interesting about that discussion were the donations that Donald Trump has made to Democrats and the way he responded when they asked him what he thought he was going to get for this money.
Right. Yeah. And it's just, he is unabashedly a crony capitalist. He admits it. He says, I pay for favors. And what is going to make him change when he's the guy sitting in the chair? He's going to say, all right, go ahead and pay me and I'll do some favors for you. I run the country now.
Exactly. That's been my point all along. He points out, look, I'm a self-made man. I've made all these billions. And I'd say, well, no. You need to look at how he made the billions. In some respects, he was a bully capitalist trying to run other people out of business, using the government to take their property for his private use using eminent domain. The other thing that should concern us is all this money that he's been passing around, and he didn't shy away from that whatsoever. Why is it going to save anything to elect a crony capitalist to president? It doesn't save anything. It just begs the question as to why he wants to be there. Is it for his own personal gain? It's not because of principles. And I think all this back and forth as to whether he's a Democrat or whether he's a Republican, they're trying to figure out where he is on issues. Is he going to do the same thing to us that we've seen from Mitch McConnell, from John Boehner, pledging to the Republican base that they're going to do something on one issue when they get elected? They do exactly the opposite. We've now had Mitch McConnell say, look, you've had your vote on Planned Parenthood. We're done. We're not going to move any further on this. We're done. Same thing we hear from John Boehner. Are we going to hear that from a Donald Trump? Is he going to just move along?
Yeah, well, and just the fact that he wouldn't take the pledge, that to me right there, I was like, he's a ringer. I mean, he knows that it could potentially give the election to the Democrats, but he doesn't care. He's already hedged his bets with Clinton, you know? Exactly. So either way, he knows if she's in, she's still going to be, you know, giving him those favors that he's already paid up for.
Exactly. And as we pointed out before, he gave $100,000 to the Clinton Foundation. He gave $25,000 to Democrat candidates in 2006. We've had some of the people who are looking at this, PolitiFact, went back and said, well, no, he's given more money to the Republicans. As you point out, when we showed the graph, you can see that he has stepped up dramatically his contributions in the last 5 years and made them exclusively Republican. Prior to that, he was giving more money to the Democrats in most years, as you can see that right there. He's had essentially a blue period, and now he's entered his red period, just like Picasso. What kind of a picture does that paint? One of the things that he said when they questioned him on, what are you going to get for all that money? And he came back and said, well, Hillary Clinton, I said, be at my wedding, and she came to my wedding. So yeah. There you go. You give the Clintons $100,000, and she will appear at your wedding. I mean, really, does he really think that that's all that we expect that he's getting from her?
Yeah, and we're seeing the same sort of passion for Trump like we saw build up for Obama. So mm-hmm. All of these people saying, yeah, simply because he speaks his mind and he's doesn't have a filter and he's not politically correct, and people sort of like that transparency. But he is the corporate, you know, oligarch that we are saying he's buying out the very politicians that we've been complaining about. You know, our country has now been bought and paid for by him.
It's still about identity politics.
Exactly.
It is still, and you see it, and that's the thing that is so disturbing, is that you see it just as much in either party. You see people not concerned about what he's going to do or his positions on issues, but you see them concerned about who he is. And if you look at those questions, the first 7 out of 8 questions were identity politics. They were about the person. They weren't about any issues. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining me in studio is Leanne McAdoo. We've been talking about the debate last night. We're going to address some of your questions on Twitter, on the Real Alex Jones Twitter account. But before we do, we want to play this clip from last night's debate where they talked about the contributions that Donald Trump is taking. What does that give him, and who is he taking money from? Here's that clip.
I will tell you that our system is broken. I give to many people. Before this, before 2 months ago, I was a businessman. I give to everybody. When they call, I give. And you know what? When I need something from them 2 years later, 3 years later, I call them. They are there for me.
So what'd
and that's
get?
A broken system.
So what'd you get from Hillary Clinton and Nancy Pelosi?
Well, I'll tell you what. With Hillary Clinton, I said, be at my wedding, and she came to my wedding. You know why? She had no choice because I gave. I gave to a foundation that, frankly, that foundation is supposed to do good. I didn't know her money would be used on private jets going all over the world. It was.
Mr. Trump, thank you. Hold on. We're gonna move on. We'll come back to you, Governor Walker.
Just 1 second on this, though. We spend a lot of time talking about Hillary Clinton and pitting us back and forth. Let's be clear. We should be talking about Hillary Clinton on that last subject, because everywhere in the world that Hillary Clinton touched is more messed up today than before she and the
president. We have many questions to come. Many questions to come.
Okay, let's hold it right there. The question, I guess, Leanne, is Donald Trump running for president, or is he running for godfather? Going back to what he says, I gave to many people before this. When I call, I give. When they call, I give. And you know what? When I need something from him 2 years later, 3 years later, I call them.
Right.
Owe me a favor.
Yeah. Okay. And does he plan on fixing that broken system?
Exactly. He offers himself as Exhibit A and says the system is broken. He plays in the broken system. So put him in charge of the broken system, because he knows how to manipulate it better than anybody else. Is there any sense of a rule of law? Is there any sense that there's too much power and money in Washington and any of that? No, there isn't. He plays the game. And so what game is he playing right now? Who is he supporting? Who sent him in here? Is he a dark horse, or is he a stalking horse?
Yeah.
Is he a stalking horse for the Clintons? They're the ones who called him. Let's play this clip from Carly Fiorina. She very succinctly summed up a lot of the questions that people have. And that's one of the reasons I think that Fox News lifted her up. But of course, we also know there's another agenda there as well. She's part of the apologists for the police state. That's another reason why Fox News wants to elevate Carly Fiorina. Let's play that clip. Have you guys got that ready? Let's play that clip of Carly Fiorina with the talking about Donald Trump.
Question, because it's true really of all of you on this stage that, like it or not, Donald Trump there's a huge disparity between the poll numbers that you have and the poll numbers that he has. Given also the fact that, you know, Rudy Giuliani said he thought that there may be some Reagan qualities to Donald Trump. So, Carly Fiorina. Is he getting the better of you?
Well, I don't know. I didn't get a phone call from Bill Clinton before I jumped in the race. Did any of you get a phone call from Bill Clinton? I didn't. Maybe it's because I hadn't given money to the foundation or donated to his wife's Senate campaign. Here's the thing that I would ask Donald Trump in all seriousness. He is the party's front runner right now, and good for him. I think he's tapped into an anger that people feel. They're sick of politics as usual. You know, whatever your issue, your cause, the festering problem you hoped would be resolved, the political class has failed you. That's just a fact, and that's what Donald Trump taps into. I would also just say this, since he has changed his mind on amnesty, on health care, and on abortion, I would just ask, what are the principles by which he will govern?
Exactly.
And I would also say, you know, she says, well, Donald Trump is a front runner, good for him. I would say that Carly Fiorina is Fox News' front runner, good for her. Right. We've had a failure not only of the system, but we've had a failure of the rule of law. And she supports that. She supports this massive surveillance state. And I can tell you that all of the candidates that we heard last night are supporting war, prohibition, surveillance, the usual list of items that we hear, except for Rand Paul. And that's where we had the one argument. Thank you so much for joining us. We're going to be joined when we come back with other members of the Nightly News. We're going to talk about the debate and the issues that came up, foreign policy and other issues. Stay with us. And joining me in the studio are Joe Biggs and Jakari Jackson. We're going to be talking about some aspects of the debate last night. We're going to move on now to some foreign policy issues. Before we do, I just want to let you know real quickly, we've extended the free shipping for July for 1 week. It ends today. You can still get free shipping on everything at InfoWarsLife.com. And we have put up a 24-hour flash sale on Survival Shield X2. That's our nascent iodine. It is 30% off. Right now, it's an unprecedented sale for nascent iodine. 30% off plus free shipping. We also have 50% off of Silver Bullet, our 30 parts per million colloidal silver in a pure base of deionized water. You can buy two, get two free for Silver Bullet. Again, everything at the InfoWarsLife.com store is available now with free shipping. 30% off Survival Shield X2 and buy two, get two free Silver Bullet. Well, gentlemen, what did you think about the debate last night? It was pretty amazing to watch it. I remember when the thing first started out, I was telling my wife, I said, this looks like a sports contest. This doesn't. And it was really the first 10 minutes before they actually started at the top of the hour. They were really hyping it up like it was some kind of a sports contest. You saw the big stadium there.
Mm-hmm. The Facebook logos everywhere.
Yeah. They made the guys parade up there and stand there. I said, wow, if they make them strip down to their swimsuits, I'm turning this off.
Yeah, it was almost NBA or NFL draft level, the way it was presented to the viewing public. But it, like Biggs was saying last night, we were watching the debate, and he said this can be the highest rated debate ever because it's an entertainment show at this point, because you have the entertainment aspect. Of course, Trump is a businessman, but he's also a reality TV star. So it's kind of like having Kim Kardashian up there talking about foreign policy. People are going to tune in and watch it. And by far, Trump was by far the most entertaining person on that stage.
Yeah, I think he won purely from an entertainment standpoint. The fact that it was the GOP versus Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. And that's the way I see it. Donald
or
Trump,
Megyn Kelly and Fox News versus Donald Trump. They clearly were going after him. The very first question
is personal questions.
Loyalty. Yeah, and the first seven out of they went seven questions talking to them personally. Mm-hmm. You know, what about you? Not even about their policies, not even about their records, but tell us about you. And the very first one was obviously targeted towards Donald Trump. They knew that he wasn't going to do that. And to his credit, he didn't do it. Yeah. But, of course, that also raises issues for many people. Is he a stalking horse for Hillary Clinton or somebody else? That's what a lot of people are concerned about.
Yeah. I mean, the second debate was dog and pony. But the first one, I've got to go back to the first one really quick. We got to talk about Lindsey Satan Graham. That's what I call him. This guy was asked questions about Planned Parenthood. And what did he give an answer to? How he would stop Planned Parenthood. He would send 25,000 troops to Iraq and Syria. And then if you didn't stand by that decision, you didn't deserve to be president of the United States. That's he was right. Then asked about border security. And this man said that he would fix border security by sending 25,000 troops to Iraq and Syria.
That's the answer to everything, Jeff.
I mean, what's going to happen if we ask him how to fix a tire? Well, I'm going to send 25,000 troops, Joe, to Iraq and Syria, and then I'm going to get a lot of money for the military-industrial complex, and then I'll hire one of those illegal guys that come across the border that we build, and I'll have him fix my tire for me.
That's right. It's the old thing is like when the only tool you've got is a hammer, everything looks like a nail.
Yeah.
Well, his same solution for everything is sending troops to the Middle East, hammering him into a war. Let's play. Have you guys got that clip ready about Lindsey Graham? Let's play that clip if you do. Yeah, go ahead. Let's play that clip. They asked him about the war on women.
This conversation will no doubt go to the war on women. And that cutting funding to this group could be a very broad brush against all of you or anybody who holds this nomination as being against women's health, against these organizations that people will say provide positive things for many women.
I don't think it's a war on women for all of us as Americans to stand up and stop harvesting organs from little babies. Let's take the money that we would give to Planned Parenthood and put it in women's health care without having to harvest the organs of the unborn. The only way we're going to defund Planned Parenthood is to have a pro-life president. You want to see a war on women? Come with me to Iraq and Afghanistan, folks. I've been there 35 times. I'll show you what they do to women. Mythical Arab.
Let's hold it right there. Let's hold it right there. Yeah.
So
you want to see a war on women? Come with me. We'll got a war on women, and we'll go against men and children as well. Yeah.
I guess everybody. If we kill everyone off, then they can't have abortions. I guess that's how he's going to stop abortions. We'll just completely annihilate them
ahead of time. Yeah.
And as we're talking about this ISIS thing, I'm very glad that Rand was there to just have the argument under the argument when he was talking about it. When he said, he didn't come out and say, let's bomb Syria and do all this other stuff. He said, let's stop funding ISIS.
Yes.
Can we just stop this one thing? Can we put this away? And I'm not saying I'm completely convinced by Rand at this point, but I'm glad he brought up this issue because they just want to blow it up, turn it into a parking lot. But he says, if we stop giving these guys the airdrop grenades, if we stop giving them $1 billion of our own Humvees to ride around in, they would be a lot easier to kill.
That's right. And we got this article today from RT. U.S. says Assad is the, quote, root of all evil, unquote, after the first drone strikes launch from Turkey. Rand Paul has said it. We've had others say it. We don't need to be al-Qaeda's air force in Syria. But that's what they've been pushing for now for years, trying to find some pretense to go into Syria. Calling them the root of all evil, that just reminds me of George H.W. Bush when he was going after Manuel Noriega, and he kept calling him strongman, Noriega.
Yeah.
I mean, it came up with this new term, strongman, whatever that means. And of course, Noriega had been involved with George Bush and the CIA. Noriega was involved in the assassination of General Torrijos in Panama. They put him in position there, running drugs, working with the CIA. And then evidently he got too big ahead and he decided he would kind of branch out and go into business for himself. So then they had to go after Manuel Noriega. But now we're talking about the moderate rebels in Syria. Remember, we've got moderate al-Qaeda. We've got moderate ISIS that we've created. Those are the good guys,
so if
the ones who are pro-U.S. rebels.
So if Jeb becomes president, that means Assad will be part of the Axis of Evil?
Yeah.
We'll continue that on?
I don't know what that means. But it's just amazing to go back and see this happen over and over again. And what you were talking about, Jakari, that was Brett Baer talking to Paul. And he says, you recently blamed the rise of ISIS on Republican hawks. Again, trying to set Paul outside of the Republicans, mm-hmm. Pit all the Republicans against him. And really, quite frankly, all the rest of the Republicans there are pushing for a war. They are pushing for arming ISIS. What Paul said, only ISIS is responsible for terrorism. Only ISIS is responsible for the depravity. How are we going to defeat ISIS? I'm the leading voice in America for not arming the allies of ISIS. He says, I've been fighting amidst a lot of opposition from both Hillary Clinton as well as some Republicans, like Lindsey Graham, mm-hmm. who want to send arms to the allies of ISIS. ISIS rides around in $1 billion worth of U.S. Humvees. It's a disgrace. We stop them by not funding them. We stop them by not arming them. And, of course, that is the solution.
I guarantee you, if Trump would not had been a part of this GOP debate, that Rand Paul would have had an extremely great chance of winning this entire debate because he gave real answers, real solutions to real problems,
yes.
real issues with America, whereas everything else was this dog and pony show.
Exactly.
And that's why they didn't give him the time to talk, because when he started speaking, they'd cut him off, or Megyn Kelly would jump in and chime in with her, Fox panel discussion.
Well, I believe that they'd put Chris Christie in there to be a pit bull to attack Rand Paul. And that's what we saw, is most of the back and forth was mm-hmm. between Chris Christie and Rand Paul. We have a Twitter comment from Starkey Joe 1, he says, were you angered when Chris Christie stooped low talking about giving hugs to 9/11 families? How manipulative, he says. Exactly. Wrapping the bloody shirt, not questioning what we could have done to stop this. And we've had NSA whistleblowers like Drake and Benny saying, look, they had the information. They could have stopped this if they wanted to. They're using this as a pretense to make a larger haystack, which makes it even harder for us to find the needle that we want to find in the haystack. But they said they were people who actually support the Constitution, unlike Chris Christie, who says you're just a bag of hot air if you talk about the Fourth Amendment. Shouldn't even talk about it. It's a dead
I mean, I'm not surprised he did that. And I guess that's the best answer I can give. You know, these guys always do anything they can to evoke this emotion. I was there and I saw it happen and all this. And maybe they did. I'm not saying they didn't. But that doesn't mean that because you hug the victims, you have more insight or care into the people who have been affected by these tragedies than anybody else.
That's right. Your comments?
Yeah, I mean, I completely agree with both of you. I mean, this guy is trying to bring up 9/11 again just so we can continuously spy on people illegally.
How many times are we going to play that card? How long is this going to go? How long are people going to give up their security in the false hope that they're going to somehow be safer? They're not safer.
And I love what he said, Rand's response, like, you need a warrant, you need a Fourth Amendment. And he was like, well, how are you going to stop people? To anybody who hasn't been keeping track, the NSA couldn't stop a bunch of trannies from attacking their own facility. How are they going to stop ISIS, a much more organized, well-funded, well-organized machine, from doing any attacks? It's like having a dictionary with no alphabetized.
Yeah.
I was pulling a George Bush there. It's not alphabetized. So it's pretty much the same thing. You have all this metadata, but you can't put it in any type of order. You have to have some way to dig through all this information.
Exactly. But we need to look at the Constitution as if it really mattered. There's a reason that we have a rule of law. There's a reason that we demanded to have search warrants, that they had to be specific about what they were looking for. There was a reason that you had to find some, you had to charge people with a crime, find them guilty before you could take their property. And now we're talking about not only just stealing people's property without charging them or finding them guilty, as we've done under the war on drugs, but now under the war on terror, we're talking about incarcerating people indefinitely by the military without even charging them. That's what's being floated out there now with this pre-crime aspect, looking for violent extremists. We've seen the bill introduced by McCall. We've seen Wesley Clark floating that issue. We've seen that this is where this is going. That's what we're concerned about with Jade Helm, with geospatial intelligence. It's all about casting a giant dragnet, getting everybody's information, putting it into a computer program, and then whoever the computer program identifies, you grab that person, throw them in jail because someday they might do something violent.
Minority Report.
Because we know computers never glitch. They never freeze up or...
That's right. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Joe Biggs and Jakari Jackson. We watched the debate last night. We've been talking about some of the foreign policy issues. Let's talk a little bit about the issues of the back and forth between Donald Trump and Fox News. Clearly, they were after Donald Trump, and Donald Trump came after them. After the debate, he tweeted out, wow, Megyn Kelly really bombed tonight. People are going wild on Twitter. Funny to watch. He said, Fox viewers give low marks to bimbo Megyn Kelly. We'll consider other programs. You know, I saw an article saying that Donald Trump had said we need to get rid of anchor babies. And when I saw that, when I first glanced at that, I thought he said, Donald Trump says we need to get rid of anchor babes. That was just kind of the psychological thing because I've seen so much of this back and forth between the two of them. And of course, then he also lashed out at Frank Luntz. And Frank Luntz, I really don't like what Fox News does in terms of manipulating the audience. They go out and they select people. They have their, oh, look, we watched the graph. This is their reactions as they're going up. I mean, who are these people that they've selected?
And a lot of people on Twitter noticed that as well. Many of the Twitter comments we have, such as this one from John D. Phil, says, who gave Fox News the authority to set up guidelines for resitting a third party? And many other people had things to say about Megyn Kelly, just the way they attacked Trump. Pretty obvious thing, so even the viewers know that they were definitely gunning. I think Big said it best, is the GOP versus Fox versus Donald Trump.
Yeah.
You know, it's pretty much what it was.
Let's look at what he said about Frank Luntz. He says, Frank Luntz, this is Donald Trump speaking, tweeted out, Frank Luntz is a low-class slob who came to my office looking for consulting work, and I had zero interest. Now he picks anti-Trump panels. Frank Luntz, your so-called focus groups are a total joke. Yes, they are. Don't come to my office looking for business again. You are a clown.
One of the things I did like that that Trump was talking about was how all these politicians try to be politically correct about everything. And he said the big problem in this country is being politically correct. I've been challenged by so many people, and I don't frankly have time for total political correctness. And to be honest with you, this country doesn't have time for that either. This country is in big trouble, and we don't win anymore. We lose to China. We lose to Mexico. We lose to everybody. So that's something that's very true. Everyone's so worried about being politically correct, trying to say the right thing so they can fit in with the right group. Mm-hmm. When sometimes you just need to go out there and be blatantly honest. And
people
you need
are
to
fed
really,
up with that. That's one of the reasons.
Well, they're tired of professional politicians.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Exactly. But they're fed up with the political correctness. You know, I don't know if you guys follow, but Top Gear, a very, very popular worldwide show out of BBC. Jeremy Clarkson was somebody who just laughed at the political correctness. And, of course, the BBC found a way to get rid of him. They were anxious when he had an altercation with one of the employees. Regardless of what you think about that altercation, the reason they got rid of Clarkson was because they couldn't stand him laughing at their political correctness. And that's what Donald Trump does. He may do it very awkwardly, like he's calling people clowns and bimbos and saying you're a fat slob, a low-class slob. You know, and again, when I look at this, we watched because this is the year that Back to the Future 2 was talking about. They did it in 1985. The first episode, they go back 30 years to 1955. The second installment, they go 30 years ahead to this year, 2015. And, you know, Lexus just came out with a hoverboard. So I said, yeah, let's told the fame. Let's watch Back to the Future 2 again. We're watching it. And we're rolling on the floor laughing because Donald Trump is Biff. As an adult, I mean, you go back to 2015, Biff's even got his casinos and his towers. And there's a clip there. You can see that clip right there. And there's even a clip where he's standing in his office talking to Michael J. Fox. And behind him, there's a big poster of Biff in a suit. And that's where he really looks like Donald Trump. You can
that's
see
funny.
This is coming up. And I can just hear Donald Trump addressing Megyn Kelly. Hello, hello.
McFly?
Banging her then. There's the picture right there. Is that Donald Trump in the background, or is that Biff Tannen? I don't know. I think it's amazing, the predictive program. How did they know that Donald Trump was going to be running for president in 2015 when they did this movie 30 years ago?
Wow, that's quite the uncanny image there.
There you go.
Yeah, we also have another Twitter question, this one from Casey Berry 92, and this person wants to know, which person do we think is going to fall to the VP status first?
I say Ted Cruz would be the...
Well, I think the person that is running... I think you got a race for vice president between Carly Fiorina and Marco Rubio. You know, Marco Rubio is a very well-polished guy that they've got there, who I don't think is qualified to run, as I said. He, Cruz, and Jindal, I don't think, meet the qualifications of a natural-born citizen. But I don't like his politics either, but Carly Fiorina would also be an obvious choice for them because they obviously were pushing her very much with Fox News. Karl Rove and all these people are pushing her. She's got close connections to the CIA.
Well, at the very end, though, too, on Hannity, we'll talk about this next on the next segment, but Marco Rubio was asked about security in America, and he said he would fix the illegal immigration problem with...
Arming the airport.
Yeah,
like airport more security. Yeah. Airport. How's that? We'll be right back. Joe Biggs and Jakari Jackson. We'll talk about that debate last night a little bit more. Stay with us. And we're going to be going to Paul Joseph Watson in the UK in just a moment. He's going to give us his comments about the debate, watching it from the UK. Of course, we had several people on Twitter commenting about Ben Carson, why he wasn't given more time. At one point, Ben Carson... they didn't talk to him for quite a while, and he goes, they'd only talked to him once, and he said, I didn't think you were going to come back to me ever again. Yeah. Well, what they said in that first question I thought was interesting, because it told us more, I think, really about Fox News than it tells us about Ben Carson. Here's what the question said. They said, you've suggested the Baltic states are not part of NATO. Just months ago, you were unfamiliar with the major political parties and the government in Israel, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm listening to this, and I'm thinking, what is he running for? Is he running for president of the United States, or is he running for emperor of a worldwide empire? And of course, the latter would be what Fox News is saying. Why does he need to know the political parties in Israel if he doesn't know the Constitution? And those are the questions and the concerns that I had about Ben Carson. is his vacillation on the right to keep and bear arms, the fact that he's made comments about how people in rural areas, yeah, they should have firearms, but not people in the cities, they really don't need them, and then coming down hard against informed consent and for mandatory vaccines. That, to me, betrays a fundamental misunderstanding about the Constitution, about individual liberty, about the purpose of the federal government.
Yeah, he's flip-flopped quite a few times on the Second Amendment, so that kind of makes me a little nervous as to what's going to happen once, if he were to get in that position and actually be president. Would he stick with how he views it now? Is he for the Second Amendment? Or is he going to go back to saying that every gun needs to be registered? We need to have this huge database. We're going to do all this. We're going to force vaccines. So I don't know. I'm not sold on him. He seems like a nice guy. The fact that he's not a professional politician, he was able to come in there. And when he was actually given time to talk, he kind of handled himself very well, I thought. So,
yeah, you know, when they're talking to him about playing geography quizzes, you know, do you know about the Baltic states? Do you know about the political parties in Israel and everything? I mean, if you're talking about running a worldwide empire, which is what they want, then you're going to ask Caesar, you know, do you know about Gaul? Do you know about Germania? You know, what are you going to do about the Vandals? You know, are you going to ban spray paint or whatever? I mean, that's the kind of concerns that we see in the kind of topics that are brought up by Fox News. They're not going to talk about individual liberty. They're not going to talk about the Constitution, except to call it a bunch of hot air when you talk about it like Chris Christie did.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of the time that everybody is getting, of course, it wasn't Ben Carson who really got the shaft on time. It was Rand Paul, and Paul Joseph Watson had an article talking about that earlier today. Thanks for joining us, Paul. Let's go to Paul Joseph Watson now in the UK. Paul, your comments on the debate last night.
Well, yeah, I put that article out earlier about Rand Paul getting less than half the time that Donald Trump got. And basically, the point I'm making is Rand Paul was the only anti-establishment candidate, really. And I mean, I'm not a fan of everything he says, but if you look at the entire field, before Donald Trump came along, Rand was the only truly anti-establishment candidate. So then Trump arrives with this populist bluster, which if you look at his actual history and his statements, even going back just 2, 4, 6 years, is complete baloney. Mm-hmm. So then they set Trump up as the establishment candidate. And in fact, I've got a video up on Infowars.com right now called Is Trump a Hillary Plant? Because if you look at the polls, Trump is way ahead of the other GOP candidates, but he has no chance whatsoever of defeating Hillary Clinton in a head-to-head. Before Trump arrived on the scene, Rand Paul was basically had the best chance out of all the GOP candidates of defeating Hillary. Now, still, people like Scott Walker are tied with Hillary, so he would have a chance in a hypothetical head-to-head. But Trump is 12% behind Hillary, even at the height of his popularity, and while Hillary is under investigation by the FBI. So given that Trump received this, you know, mysterious phone call back in May, shortly before he made his announcement, I think he's a ringer. I think he's a stooge for Hillary Clinton. I really think that's what's going on.
Well, you know, Paul, he gave the Clinton Foundation over $100,000, but it was just to get her to come to his wedding. That's what he said last night.
No, I mean, you can go, and obviously he's donated money to other people, but then you look at his statements about how kind and generous he's been. And in fact, they're in the video. You look at Bill Clinton's statements about how kind and generous he's been. Then he gets a phone call right before his presidential announcement from Bill Clinton. And there's an article in The Hill which says, if Bill Clinton had told him all these things to do, then that's what you would expect Trump to do. You know, attack other GOP candidates personally, alienate Hispanic voters. He's done all these things that someone like Clinton would have told him to do if his intention was to sabotage the GOP race and ensure that Hillary's going to come out on top. Because remember, before Bilderberg, we released the article where Hillary's top advisor, who also advised Obama, was at Bilderberg. And we basically made the prediction that she was the elite's pick. And that's exactly what's going on. And if, you know, if conservatives want Hillary Clinton to become president, then they should keep supporting Donald Trump, because that's exactly what's going to happen.
Well, it's not only that, but he's also a stalking horse for Jeb Bush, because Jeb Bush last night was talking about how they asked him questions about the foundation that he was a director of with Bloomberg, giving $10 million to Planned Parenthood. And he said, oh, well, it was just because we were really, it wasn't that. I thought it was to promote education. Well, what was the education he was promoting? That was the other thing that was talked about, Common Core. So here's a guy promoting abortion with Planned Parenthood, as we mentioned earlier in the program. Both his father and his grandfather were closely tied to Planned Parenthood. He's pushing Common Core. He's pushing open borders. So when you got Donald Trump out there personally attacking people who are coming across, rather than talking about our enticement, our open borders, then that opens up an area for Jeb Bush to look like a good guy, the good guy out of the GOP. So he's really a stalking horse for Jeb Bush as well. He makes the Republican Party look bad, but then he makes Jeb Bush look like a quote-unquote compassionate conservative, which was the beard that his brother ran with.
Yeah, and, you know, it's the same with Bush, as you mentioned, with Trump. You know, Bush made a lot of populist statements that resonated with a lot of people. You know, we're not going to be the global policeman. Same as Obama, you know, we're going to reverse the Patriot Act. We're going to shut down Guantanamo Bay. We're going to get out of all these wars. And basically, Trump's running on the same populist platform, but there's no substance whatsoever. And in fact, you know, the big reaction is, oh, look how evil Fox News is baiting Donald Trump. Well, actually, they gave him the platform to do what he does best, which is firing back with these witty retorts and giving him the opportunity to make more of these, you know, populist statements and making politically incorrect statements rather than actually focusing on his record, which is, you know, is not conservative.
Yes.
2-4 years ago, he was anti-abortion. He was pro-open borders, and they don't grill him on it. And Trump claims that he suddenly, quote, politically evolved. Okay, you politically evolve from a liberal to a conservative between the ages of, what, 18 to 30 maximum. Donald Trump is 69. You don't just suddenly flip from being a liberal to a conservative when you're 69 years old, unless there's another agenda going on. And yes, it's partly his ego, why he wants to become president at all, but I think it's partly because, you know, he's been sent to sabotage the whole process.
Well, you got Tea Party conservatives, and the Tea Party was really founded in opposition to crony capitalism. That was one of the core things about it. And yet here they are coalescing, so many of them, behind someone who has unabashedly been a crony capitalist and said, hey, the system's broken. I'm using the system the way I want it. I give money to these guys. Yeah, I give it left and right. I'm a businessman. That's the way I do business in America. Then saying, when I need a favor, I call him in 2 or 3 years. I mean, he really does sound like the godfather, not somebody who is running for president.
Yeah, and it's not only the Clintons, you know, Clinton Senate campaign and the Clinton Foundation, who he's donated to. You know, look at who else he's given money to. Chuck Schumer, the big gun control guy. Harry Reid. Probably don't have to remind listeners about, you know, what he said about the Clive and Bundy supporters last year, calling them domestic terrorists. He donated money to Anthony Weiner as well, amongst all these other top Democrats, not moderate Democrats, but extreme left-wing Democrats that push all this anti-conservative crap. And then he suddenly turns around and says, oh, I've politically evolved and become a conservative at the age of 69. I simply don't believe it.
I don't either. What do you guys think about what Paul is saying here? I'll give you guys a chance to jump in.
I thought he made some excellent points. Just like he was saying, how your political ideology evolves when you make the point that he's not in that 18 to 30 range. You know, I think that is very suspect. But, you know, it's not just Trump. It's many of these guys that I take exception with talking about the records on many other things, not just the things that we've mentioned here.
You know, one of the things that I was looking at, I'm curious to get your take on, Paul. You have a very different political system. You have very lively debates in the House of Commons there. And when anybody here in the United States, like Ted Cruz, came out and pointed out that Mitch McConnell had lied about the Trans-Pacific Partnership and these trade deals, he was excoriated by the leadership there. How do people in Britain react about this sports and weather entertainment debate system that we've got here last night? I mean, I was absolutely appalled about it, and I'm used to seeing that kind of stuff here in America. What's the reaction in the UK and in Britain?
I think British people are quite used to seeing that for everything in relation to how, you know, Americans respond, not just politics. So it's nothing out of the ordinary. The kind of debates that we saw before the UK election earlier this year, they're not obviously dressed up in the pageantry that you have over there. They were quite lively, but I don't think it would be a surprise to people who live in the UK as to the whole, you know, spectacle that surrounds these kind of debates. But apparently it was Fox News' most popular broadcast ever. They're talking about 24 million people who watched it. Mm-hmm. So from that standpoint, I guess at least it might reinvigorate some people who are on the fringes, who are not really interested in politics, and it might get them back involved.
Well, you know, what we've seen in the previous discussions, what we saw in the junior varsity debate in the afternoon, and what we saw in the New Hampshire debate on Monday, were some very staid and tired, controlled discussions where they got up there and just read talking points that they had prepared ahead of time. This debate, they engaged in some very lively back and forth debating. And of course, we had that back and forth between Chris Christie and Rand Paul. My take on all this, Paul, and I want to get your take on it, is I think that they brought Chris Christie in simply as the pit bull to go after Rand Paul, while Megyn Kelly went back and forth with Donald Trump. I think they really wanted to have someone there who was going to go head-to-head with Rand Paul. And that's what we saw with the fireworks going on back and forth between those two.
Well, yeah, they had Trump right in the center. That's always, you know, a ploy to throw the most attention on whoever's right in the center. Rand Paul was right off on the wing. So, you know, physically he was removed from the spotlight. And in fact, someone pointed out that even though Rand Paul had, according to some accounts, less than 5 minutes talk time in comparison to Donald Trump's 11 minutes, almost half of that was other people talking over him.
Yeah.
So he didn't even get a full 5 minutes. He basically got 2.5 minutes to talk.
But the things that Ron Paul said were
that's
better.
How they controlled it.
Go ahead.
The things
ahead.
That Ron Paul actually said, though, were actually legitimate answers, legitimate things about what our country needs. Whereas, like with Trump and all that, it was just this, like I said, it was just personal attacks. It was Fox News trying to attack this person, Donald Trump trying to attack again.
Attacking
it went away
Rosie
from
McDonald,
a debate, yeah, yeah. And it went into this whole like comedy skit. It was like a skit from Saturday Night Live. Mm-hmm. And I almost half expected for these candidates to walk out wearing NASCAR jackets with all their sponsor logos on it, because that's the way they promoted this, you know, show today. It was like a comedy show.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the fact checks that we saw, and of course, what most of the gubernatorial candidates will do is they'll come out and talk about how many jobs they create. And so now we're seeing fact checks about this, where Jeb Bush says, we created 1.3 million jobs. We led the nation 7 out of 8 of those years. And it's like, well, no, not actually. Scott Walker then comes out. I came in with an unemployment rate of over 8%. Now it's down to 4.6% and so forth and so on. This is what we see from the gubernatorial candidates. Throwing out these numbers, every one of them created more jobs than anybody else did. And then
and also Christie saying that you think it's bad now, you should have saw it when I first got there.
Yeah, because he couldn't make any case. He just said, yeah, well, we're
Jersey's
doing
always been bad.
Got there.
Jersey's always been bad. So what do you expect?
Yeah, the low achiever right there. But then, of course, what we see from Donald Trump is he inflates his net worth, according to many people. They say that he put it out there as having a net worth of $10 billion. But then the fact checkers say, well, no, maybe it's $3 or $4 billion. I've seen other things that put it at $7 billion. Is this really what's important? You know, this is what we see each time we come through. And it really bothers me to see these Republican candidates out there all the time about how they created jobs. It's like, well, if you reduce taxes, if you reduce regulation, which most of these guys have not really done, then you can have an environment there where some other people can put their money at risk. And they can work hard, and then they create jobs. But I hate to see these politicians. It really grates on me, especially to see Republican politicians taking credit for jobs that are created. We even had Jeb Bush talking about how many jobs he was going to create in the future. I mean, he didn't even get to the point where he was talking about how many jobs he had created. He's got a figure that he's going to create if he becomes president in the future, this astronomical
figure. And also, a lot of these are government jobs that come to these various states, especially, you know, states like here in Texas. You got a lot of government jobs down here.
Well, we had Obama say, I had this many jobs saved or created. Okay, because he says, well, yeah, these are people that would have been laid off. And it's like, how can you even measure that? That's a metric that you can't come up with. It's just like Jeb Bush talking about his future jobs that he's going to have.
Well, it seemed like all the candidates up there were shooting from the hip with their replies, except for Jeb Bush. It seemed like everything he had, he stuck with a script. It was already pre-written out, and he just rolled with that. It was this cookie-cutter political response.
He is well-coached.
Do you guys have that clip about Jeb Bush where he said, they call me Jeb?
That was the most ridiculous thing.
You're talking about
being a woke coach.
I
mean,
when I saw that, I said, I don't know, this guy may actually be dumber than W. At one point, the very first question to Jeb Bush is, how do you distinguish yourself from your brother and from your father? And so he wants to say that he's his own man.
Well, they call me Jeb.
And then he says this. He says, I've got a record in Florida. I'm proud of my dad. I'm certainly proud of my brother. In Florida, they call me Jeb because I earned it. Now,
what does that even mean?
What does it mean when they call you Jeb?
I don't want to ever earn a Jeb.
Story about a man named Jed.
I don't want to earn a Jeb at all. I don't even know what that means. I want to get off that path of earning a Jeb.
Nobody called him one of that. I rolled out of my chair laughing at that point. It's like, what in the world is he talking about? So yeah, he also puts himself out there as a pro-life candidate. We've talked about that a great deal in this program about the Bush family's involvement with Planned Parenthood. It takes more than just okaying a driver's license plate that says I'm pro-life to be pro-life. Your family supports it from the get-go. The Bush family is essentially like the Bill Gates family. They've been in this thing from the very beginning. And that's the simple truth, folks. We've got a lot of masks that we need to pull off between now and the election. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Paul Joseph Watson, Joe Biggs, and Ja'Kari Jackson. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. Joining me in Austin here in the studio are Joe Biggs and Ja'Kari Jackson. Joining us from the UK is Paul Joseph Watson. We're going to go back to him in just a moment, get his comments about the debate last night. Just want to let you know that Super Male Vitality is back after having been sold out for weeks. We now have it back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. We have free shipping that ends tonight. We have extended the July free shipping for 1 week, but that ends tonight. But we have a shipment of Super Male Vitality just got off the truck today. We are now taking orders on that. You can look at the reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. It has hundreds of five-star reviews. We also have a 24-hour special on Survival Shield X2. An unprecedented special, 30% off. And again, free shipping on that. And we also have one more special, Silver Bullet. We have buy two, get two free. So all those specials and free shipping on everything at InfoWarsLife.com. Let's go back to Paul Joseph Watson. Paul, your comments on the debate we have. This is the last segment we have with you. I just wanted to get your final comments on this.
Well, there's an article out of Bloomberg today. Fox News couldn't kill Trump's momentum and may have only made it stronger. So there was all this, you know, stuff about, oh, Fox News is really going to go after Trump. Megyn Kelly is going to throw the misogyny card at him, giving him the opportunity to be politically incorrect. You know, everyone in the audience whoops and hollers. Mm-hmm. They're not grilling him on the fact that he's pro-abortion and pro-open borders. If they actually did that, it would expose Donald Trump for the ringer that he is. So to claim that Fox News is going after him is complete BS, because now his popularity has only soared. That's why they call him, you know, Teflon Trump, because when people attack him, it only makes him stronger. So instead of analyzing and grilling his actual record, they try these, you know, feminist talking points, which are not going to resonate with conservative audiences. So, you know, again, if you actually grill him on his record and his flip-flopping, then he would lose a lot of support. But for the moment, that's not going to happen. And in fact, he's only getting more popular thanks to Fox News.
Well, of course, they like to skew everything towards personalities. It's all about identity politics. It's all about personalities. They want to invite these back and forth conflicts because that makes for an exciting news program. But as one of the comments here on Twitter says, why didn't any other candidate defend and declare the Constitution and go after Christie? Besides Rand Paul. Of course, we wouldn't have had anything of any substance. They have such a narrow range of issues that they talk about. As you were talking about before, Joe, Lindsey Graham, when he was talking, every solution was let's invade the Middle East. Yeah. Let's send a massive number of troops to the Middle East, no matter what the situation. He even takes a question about abortion and turns that into invading the Middle East.
Yeah, Trump was also asked about his declaration 15 years ago that he backed a single-payer healthcare system. An idea despised by Republicans. It could work at a different age. What is this age you're talking about here? Also citing success of the program in Canada and Scotland, Trump added he backs private insurance now. But Paul interjected, the Republican Party has been fighting against the single-payer system for decades, so I think you're on the wrong side of this if you're still arguing for a single-payer.
Exactly. When you look at all of these different issues, Trump is arguing for exactly the same policies that the Democrats are arguing for, yep. which makes perfect sense as to why he would support so many Democrat politics until about 5 years ago when he stopped making contributions to the Democrats and he started making heavy, exclusive contributions to Republicans trying to build connections and inside the Republican Party and allies there.
Well, a lot of people who are also contributing money to Hillary Clinton are also giving money to Jeb Bush. Actually, a lot of those people are giving more money to Jeb Bush, so that's a very interesting thing that's going on as well.
It's the same group of bankers. We've got the Goldman Sachs family. It's not really a Game of Thrones.
As long as they get one of them in there, they don't care. Yeah, they know they're going to get what they want.
Well, they always do that. They always have both sides of it. Well, that's it for today's show. Thanks for joining us. Paul Joseph Watson in the UK, Joe Biggs, and Jakari Jackson. Join us tonight for the InfoWars Nightly News at 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m.